Yo, guys, what up, what up, what up? Guess who? It's your friendly neighborhood complicated Chelsea showboys, guys. You know, as much as you want to hate us, you know you love us, man. You know you love us, man. And a special shout out to the proper Chelsea fans, man. We love you, man. We love you. Proper Chelsea fans. What up, baby? Rory Jennings, man. What up, yo? What up, yo? Rory Jennings, man. What's up, baby? So to all of you guys, and to what's it called? You know, I'm going to share some of the, you know, remember my dear friend, Callum.Keith from Instagram?
Oh my God, yes.
He's continued to send me messages and without me responding over a period of days. He's amazing. This dude is amazing. So I will send some more, I'll share some more Callum.Keith Instagram DMs, man.
Unofficial fifth member.
Yeah. So guys, look, man, we've got so much stuff to break down, a lot of stuff to break
first,
down.
First things first, though, guys, help us out, bro. There's a link in the description with Manscaped.
Oh yeah.
If there's a lady in your life, if you don't like being ungroomed or whatever it is, remember, man, there's Manscaped for you, man. It's an easy way to shave your balls.
Make your balls look good,
even,
man.
Even if you're on the caveman side of the game, you can still use it for other stuff on your body. So,
yeah, man.
Everybody, it's a good product. I've tested it for myself. It's nice.
Man's been on the lawnmower, bro.
Yeah.
I didn't cut myself. So
it even has
good.
A lights, man.
So, look, if you want to help the complicated Chelsea show and you like what we do, and you want this to keep going, help us with our sponsor, guys. So
yeah, man.
You know, your wife, your lady, your boyfriend, whomever, they will thank you for it. So there you go.
So yeah, so basically, so the link is in the description box.
CCS, get, like, a percentage
20% off. So you get 20% off if you use the code CCS, which is of course what you get to show. So you just click the link below in the description box, use CCS as the code, and you will get 20% off. And it's a great package because it comes like a nice satchel. This ball shaver.
I didn't use
shaver.
The ball toner.
It's the lawnmower, bro.
Lawnmower. So no, it's alright. No, I have used it. It's a nice shave, and I think the light helps, which is what the devil says to me. The lights. It helps.
It actually does. Yeah, no,
because the light in my toilet isn't that bright, so it's one of those like really weak yellow lights. So yeah, it actually does help. So I don't shave my balls off, you know, and. Yeah, look, I'm being real, man. So there is so much stuff to discuss.
He's gone, okay? This is our first episode since he's gone.
Lots happened since the last episode, man.
Yeah, let's discuss him being
eliminated. Okay, so let me just hit this.
Let me go do my own shave your balls. I'm coming.
What?
I'm gonna go be my own Manscaped.
Excuse me? I think Abdullah, he's using the product right now, like this very second.
Please no. Please go. Don't tell me that he's using the product right now. I'm begging you. Please don't use it right now. Use it afterwards or before. Don't use the thing right. Lord in heaven. Okay, so let's just go through. While
I'm not using it. I want to advertise my own. They need to use Manscaped, so I want to advertise. I'm not using it.
Just continue, man.
Okay, look. Let's continue. So, look, man. Lampard, man. So I just have some a certain things to say because I think that I'm not one of those guys that say, like I say, I told you so. But I'm gonna say I told you so.
I am.
You don't know yet because I'm petty, and I think Eddie did say that. You know what? Eddie said, you know what, let's just chill and let's just get at certain guys come Thursday. And I'm going to say I told you so because people swore by me that said he'd be given till the end of the season. People swore by me that said that, oh, this is a process. He needs to be backed and so forth. And the reality of the matter is, and I kept saying this throughout, I've invested some money in. I cannot invest money into academy players. It didn't make any logical sense that Abramovich will sit idly by and just say, introduce this young English youth academy players into the team and let's just have a 2-3-year process and slowly groom them. No, that was never really going to happen. And for a while, I thought the homeboy was going to last until the end of the season because I was like, has he changed? has it changed? But I was like, Russian billionaire, I know Russians, I don't think they'll change. But lo and behold, he did what he had to do. Homeboy did what he had to do. And I think that, you know, if you know what Abramovich is like and know what he's about, then you know that this guy doesn't change. So, but my main thing is this, and I think this is probably a good entry point for us to come to, and I'm going to come first to Daniel with this, is that there are like the banners at Stamford Bridge, the people who say that you've taken the soul out of the club. How could you sack him? It's terrible, specifically the English media and the journalists, because it seems as if the English media, who are supposed to be objective and professional, as a journalist, you're supposed to be objective and professional, are showing extreme bias and subjectivity, because the way you're reporting on Lampard's dismissal, who is statistically the worst Chelsea manager that Abramovich has ever had, the way that they reported on his dismissal is very different from the reported the AVB dismissal, the Sarri dismissal, and the Sofa dismissal, because guys have brought up things. And I was reading an article, Henry Winter, one of the most esteemed, well-known journalists in England and so forth. The way that this guy talked about Lampard's dismissal and so forth, the key word he used, said that he likened Lampard to Bambi. Have you guys seen Bambi? You've all seen Bambi, obviously.
Yes.
Good. He likened Lampard to Bambi, that they shot Bambi. And I was like, I remember, first of all, depressing Disney cartoon, one of the most depressing. Bro, he didn't know Robin Hood or Basil the Great Mouse Detective, man. I was about to say, wait a minute. I was like, Mom, why are you showing this to me? This is freaking depressing. But the narrative that has been put out of Lampard being sacked has been sickening. Sentimental crap, sentimental nonsense. And it's as if people are like, oh my gosh, you've done such a horrible thing, such a bad thing. Because see, I live in England. I don't know how English people think. And I know how extremely biased English people are. They wanted Lampard to succeed so badly. And they didn't. And they refused to look at objectivity. And growing up in England, I just know how extremely skewed English journalism can be, specifically with people who they view as one of their own guys that they like. Because English people can bring down their own, as they did with David Beckham. You know, how they completely just ransacked him after the 98 World Cup. But the way that they just have a guy that they choose and rally around him, it's insane. But for me, before I give this to Daniel, my thing is this. You know who Abramovich is. You know what he's about. It's similar to Perez and Real Madrid. Arsenal fans, Liverpool fans, and Arsenal fans, Liverpool fans, and United fans would kill to have an owner like Abramovich, who he cares about the club. He's a football fan. And he's like, bro, what do you need? Who do you need? I'm willing to invest. And there's a funny thing as well, as like, because we now are learning more about Lampard and so forth with regards to Chilwell was apparently the only player that he truly vouched and fought for. Chilwell. Did Lampard ever go to Abramovich with actual targets apart from Basmati Rice?
Yeah.
Because my thing is that if these players that you had weren't your targets, who were your targets? And were they rejected? Or what kind of targets did you actually go? Because obviously there was money available. So did you go to Marina and say, I need these five players? Or was it like, oh, Chilwell, Basmati Rice, and okay, whoever you give me, I'll work with. Daniel, talk to me, man.
Go to Eddie, because Eddie probably has...
Eddie, yeah.
No, Daniel, you can go. Daniel, you go.
I don't know who he wanted. Like you.
No. I said Daniel. I said Daniel.
No, I mean I don't.
He's talking of his targets.
I don't know who Lampard wanted, but Eddie.
No.
So
I was just going off a tangent. So just Lampard. Oh. Just Lampard been thinking.
What about him?
Thoughts. Review. Do you want to say I told you so? Do you want to go after some people that's called you a liar and a freaking hater?
I mean,
or a racist, anti-English. Well,
nobody's ever called me racist.
You've said some things.
I think I said this like maybe a couple months ago. I like being right more than I like Chelsea, so that's kind of where I start this from. So I don't. What happens with Chelsea, whether they win or lose, doesn't bother me too much. But I do like being right. So I've decided over maybe like the past 48 hours that like Chelsea is what I use to kind of, I don't know, just get more knowledge about football, I suppose. So like they're kind of like my case study at this point. So like obviously I have the depth and knowledge of being a fan, but as that kind of wanes, I still pay attention to Chelsea, and they're kind of like my case study. So that's the club I pay most attention to. So when I see something happening, for instance, the Lampard hiring, I'll tell you it's wrong. I don't really care about your feelings in that sense, because my attachment to Frank Lampard isn't someone who's like he was on my wall as a child or something like that. Like that's not my attachment to him. So when he was doing wrong things, I said he was doing wrong things, and eventually, you know, he had to leave. I mean, that's just kind of is what it is. I am surprised because I did think he'd get to the end of the season. But I mean, I guess if your workplace is kind of toxic in a sense and the results aren't kind of bearing fruit, then you got to go. So I don't know how much more we can add to this, because this is like week 7, week 8 of the same topic. I've basically said all I can say about Lampard in that way. So I don't know what to give you. Do I keep filibustering so you can finish your food? All right.
No. I just had to swallow. Pause. What do you make of specifically the reactions of the proper fans, English media, journalism, and so forth?
To be expected. He's one of their own, as they say, you know. So, you know, the idea that he's Bambi, or he needs to be more respected, or all of these types of things, or he needs more time, all of this kind of stuff. I mean, I think he got more time than a lot of other managers who had more qualifications. So Scolari, did he deserve more time? If Lampard deserved more time, did Ancelotti clearly deserve more time? If Lampard deserves more time, VS Boas probably deserved more time.
How long was Scolari in there before he got? Was it a
7
season?
Months. 7 months.
Wow.
So he was hired in June 2008, right after Grant, and then he left, I think, February 2009. And then Hiddink came in. Obviously, what happened in the semifinal happened with Hiddink. But yeah, he got 7 months. World Cup winner, all of that. Didn't matter. So if Lampard deserves more time, again, I was going to say, like, if VS Boas deserved more time, you know, he won with Porto. They paid £13 million, I think, to get him out of his Porto contract. Why didn't he deserve more time if Lampard did? And Lampard was in the job for 18 months, 19 months, something along those lines. That's like double what all these other guys have gotten, even with more credentials. So the idea that he deserves more time than the time he was allotted is, that's just nonsense. Not to mention, and I'll end here, Arsenal 4 weeks ago were in a relegation battle. So it said, if you look at the table now, they're 2 places above Arsenal. So where was Frank Lampard leading you in that way? I don't think he deserved more time. But I understand the English media wanting him to have more time, because, you know, he is who he is.
Edward?
Hey, look, like the great Stephen A says, in terms of their reaction, you're not wrong. What? It had to happen. I'm sorry. Initial reactions, I mean, we saw it on Monday or Tuesday, whenever he got sacked. I mean,
yeah, man, I'm Lampard out, everyone, Eddie. I'm Lamparded out. Like, I've talked about him so much, I'm just exhausted. I'm on.
Yeah. Like, but when you sit down and think about it and see all the stories that's come out and digest everything, one thing I kind of came up with was Lampard was used, plain and simple. And Lampard actively engaged in a battle with the board through the media. That's why you can see the reaction like this. Because when you read stories, Lampard's minimum expectation last season was top 4. That's what the board told him. Because if you see the report that came out, it was like top 4 was not a top four was not a.
It was not deemed as a success.
Yeah, it wasn't. So it tells you that the board told Lampard, look, you're walking in right now, top four, because we're giving you about five or six academy products. I think Hazard was the only guy to leave last season, if I'm not mistaken. And the whole team pretty much stayed the same. So what they basically told him was, he got rid of Luis though. Before Lampard came in. So Hazard was the only player to go. So they basically told him, you're taking over a Europa League winning squad that Sarri just won Europa with. Hazard's the only player winning. You're bringing in, you know, youth products like Abraham, Mount, and all this. Top four. And Lampard went ahead to start tempering the fans' expectations. You know, if you look at what he said last season, top four was not even, you know, a thing for him last season. It was more, yeah, we'll see how we go and all that kind of stuff. So he kind of put it in the fans' head that, look, if I get top four this season, it's a big achievement. And the board were like, no. Hold on a second. Top four is minimum. Like, that's where the bar is. I mean, I think it was top four last season, title challenge this season. That's what was said for Lampard. And I think, besides the player thing, I mean, we all know what happened with David Luiz. Fairly simple. Daniel's spoken about that enough for people to gather what happened with David Luiz. Daniel Luiz. But I mean, everything started to go down. I think everything started to go down in the January transfer window. Because remember, Lampard came into the job with Chelsea having two windows to go on the transfer ban, but it got reduced sometime in December. So when it gets reduced, Lampard's like, okay, cool. You want me to get top four? Get me players. Like, I want Ziyech, I want Aubameyang. I think those were the two key players he wanted. But the board obviously didn't do nothing, because I remember vividly Lampard's conference on transfer deadline, I think just after the January thing. He didn't look happy at all. I remember him, he tried to brush it off, obviously, but you could tell that, look, this guy wasn't happy that players weren't brought in, because, I mean, all Chelsea fans expected that as soon as the ban got lifted for January, we're buying players. Like, the young players have done their thing, but look, let's buy more players. What happened to David Luiz? Go research it, man.
I've got tweets, I'm sure.
Ask Daniel. go on the description and get Daniel's Twitter. You'll see it there. But yeah, I think January is where everything started to go down. And Lampard walked into the Chelsea job without, I won't say a sense of self-awareness, but he didn't want to recognize who was the top boss at Chelsea. That's just plain and simple. I think he expected this to be similar to Derby, where everyone's starstruck, like you're Frank Lampard, you're, you know, one of England's great midfielders, Chelsea legend, 211 goals, and they gave him that respect, I think, within the club of Derby. But when you walk into Chelsea, you're walking into, you know, Marina. And as Abdullahi says, these Russians are crazy. They don't care who you are, man. It's, do you want to do a job for us or
my sugar daddy? Sugar daddy is the best. He's the best, man. He's the best.
Okay, yeah. Chill with that.
So you're walking into a situation where you're not the top guy. You're supposed to do the job, but because he thought it was Mr. Chelsea, he could talk to the fans, and that's why I said everything made sense. Because Lampard wanted the fans back so quickly during this COVID thing. I don't know if you guys realize, since August, when he was going through all these battles with Marina, he knew that if the fans were in the stadium, he would still be there right now.
That's a great point. That is a great... Why was he fighting so hard for the fans to be back even during COVID?
During COVID, this guy was talking about, you know, the government allowing fans to come back. People need to come and enjoy their food. I keep saying everything made sense.
Was it Everton that Chelsea had them in the stadium and there were like 2,000 and he stayed just walking around the stadium for like 5 hours?
Nah, that was Everton away though. It wasn't Chelsea. It wasn't.
So which was the game
Chelsea,
where there were fans?
Chelsea
in the
never
stadium?
Had fans. Chelsea never had fans.
They did.
I think that they did. There was definitely one game where they had like the 2,000 quota. I mean, can anybody in the live chat tell us if what was the Chelsea game where they had that 2,000 quotes? If anybody can tell us,
because I remember Chelsea playing Everton and they had the two. That was the first week of the 2000.
Leeds.
Oh, okay.
Leeds. Oh, and I know, because I remember for sure there was one game where
there was a game where there were hella fans and he was just walking around just clapping for like minutes, and it made sense because he was trying to kind of stoke. Also, Leeds was a pretty good performance, to be fair. So I'm told, but
yeah. So I'm told. Nah, but I think you then go to August. I think where Lampard decided all of a sudden, or I think July. When was the transfer window? When Lampard decided to build Brexit FC.
This he was guy trying to wanted... do that from the beginning, though, Eddie.
Yeah, but, I mean, he took it to a whole nother level this season. after getting top four. Because he got top four last season, he was like, okay, cool, I got your minimum expectations. Now can I get my players? Because you want to transfer... You want to... What did they want? A title challenge. He asked for Nick Pope. This guy asked for James Tarkowski. Luis Dunk. Ben Chilwell and Declan Rice. Bro, look at these targets, man. Like,
that's sick, man. Like, you know, for me, it's like, I refuse to believe that. I actually refuse to believe that. I don't believe he asked for those players.
I do.
But that's insane. No, it isn't. If you're being told that.
If you jump into the mind of Frank Lampard, is that insane?
Yes. Okay. Let me explain. It is still insane where we want to win the title. Do you really believe that these targets you've been put forth can win us the Premier League title against De Bruyne, flipping Ferran Torres, Mane thingy? These are guys, world known, renowned guys. I'm giving you $200 million to spend.
Inside the mind of Frank James Lampard, I'm sure that makes sense. Just like give me guys who I know, who will try, who will work hard, and we can do X, Y, Z. I can win a Champions League.
I think that was a common thing with all these players. They could run hard and tackle and all this. But
he was probably looking, okay, like, I need a John Terry, I need a Gary Cahill, I need a this, I need a that. Like, that's probably what he's up to.
So I think the club got him Ziyech, I think 1 month after he asked for Ziyech. So Ziyech was a Lampard signing. But if you go to this summer, Timo Werner, the clubs for an opportunity, and we needed a striker anyways. They went and got him. Who else was signed before? I mean, the Havertz thing dragged on, but you knew the club. Those two were pretty much club signings.
Silva.
Yeah, I think Silva was the alternative to Tarkowski. Silva was the guy Chelsea got instead of getting Tarkowski. So, hey, I'm happy with that, man.
Why would Chelsea sign Sarr from Nice?
That was more of a financial deal, in my opinion.
Do you think they sign him for free and then he has a 5-year contract? He's worth 25 billion. They sell him.
Exactly. Yeah, okay. They sell him. Yeah. He could. I don't see him playing for Chelsea with the. I mean, if we're going in for Pamecano and Marquinhos and all that in summer,
that's what I'm saying. So like, there must be just club signings. Is more the point.
Yeah.
Not every signing that comes into the club, the manager has their hands in.
Yeah.
If that was the case, then you wouldn't pick up Sarr.
That's how Chelsea work, anyways. Like,
wait. So you're saying Thiago Silva was categorically not a Lampard signing?
He wasn't.
It doesn't make sense. It never made sense that you would pick a 36, 37-year-old.
And talk about a process.
At the expense of Tomori, who you played 50 times at Derby. That never quite added up in my mind.
Like, so this was a war between Lampard and Marina.
That's what was going on this whole time.
That's what it always is. Many times, like... lady has all the power, bro.
But this seems much more as a more stark contrast, because what Lampard wants seems to be completely to the left of what Marina wants. It just seems as if they were coming from completely different like galaxies.
Okay, have hope. Do you remember one of those points that was on The Athletic that said something to the extent of, if Lampard wasn't at Chelsea, he would have just walked away.
Yeah,
that is exactly what Conte would have done, had he not wanted his severance package. But Conte had no loyalty to Chelsea, so he's just like, I'll just ride it out, get my severance package. Even I'll sue you after I leave. I think he could only sue for like amount that was like 70k, but he did it anyway, just because he's petty. But yeah, like Lampard was probably in that similar situation where I want these kinds of players. Conte wanted old, experienced, veteran. Give me Graziano Pella, Llorente. Give me a Vidal. Give me or just any trash player who I think will fit in my system, essentially, who's above the age of 33. That's who he wanted. And the club was like, no, we're not going to do that. Lampard's was give me Tarkowski, give me Pope, give me Declan Rice, try to get me Chilwell, et cetera, et cetera. That probably conflicted with the board's ideas as well. So it's just that Lampard had the loyalty to Chelsea to where he wouldn't leave in that and way.
I think the only reason they got Chilwell was because they got priced out of Tagliafico. And Real Madrid wanted to insert the buyback with Reguilón because
because look, I was hearing something that was, that's like Reguilón was on the cards.
Mm-hmm. Reguilón was the how, was the club, yeah.
There were three before
Chilwell,
Tagliafico,
and Telles.
So saying that, so Lampard specifically went for Chilwell over those dudes, or
yeah.
Chilwell wanted England. Oh, Chilwell. Lampard wanted English talent.
English
in the
players,
team.
Yeah.
No, wait. Okay, I need to just understand this, please. I'm begging you. Just.
It's simple.
No. I just want to specialize.
If your father, mother, or grandparents were English, and you have the what is it? A blue passport, red passport, whatever
red,
the color
red,
is.
Red
passport. You were aligned. You were a candidate to be chosen by Frank Lampard in the summer. It's simple.
No. So just so we're clear, he opted for Chilwell over Tagliafico and Reguilón.
That is the presumption, yes.
Yeah.
That is sickening. And for that, I never want to see your face ever again. Sorry, Eddie, continue.
Wait, you didn't know this? Because,
no.
I mean...
No. It's like, this is...
The summer, remember, Leicester City asked for 80 million for Ben Chilwell. And the club went, look, we're not paying 80. So we're going to focus on all these other targets, and they were all cheaper. But the thing is, I think Ajax bumped the price on Tagliafico, and I don't know what happened with Telles.
There was a bidding war probably between United and Chelsea, probably.
I think PSG were also in for Telles as well. That was another thing. So the Telles thing was kind of murky to start with. The only guy Chelsea had a clear path to was Tagliafico. But the problem was Real Madrid wanted to buy this guy back after X amount of years. And they wanted the money slapped in there. So Chelsea don't do business like that, because the way Chelsea do business is we buy you for cheap, we sell you for X amount of money, we at least get our money back minimum. Well, good luck with that with Kepa. But that's the way Chelsea do business. That's why we ended up going back for Ben Chilwell, because it was, okay, we can negotiate this down to 50. Let's get him. That's how Lampard got Chilwell. So, and again, it makes sense why there were players who came out to say Lampard didn't give no tactical instructions. Could these players be Kai Havertz and Timo Werner? Because we hear stories of Lampard talking to the players he liked and the players he played, and you know, just talking to So if these guys are not your signings, you're literally just telling the Kai Havertz, go out there and express yourself, like this is your position. Mm-hmm. And man doesn't know what he's doing. Timo Werner, how did Timo Werner play nearly 10 games on the wing and this guy could not be direct and be the man? Like, it's starting to make sense what Lampard...
I think that's the scary thing, because like I think what you're now seeing is that these are not his players, and because they're not his players, he's just going to be like... And because he specifically wanted an English core, you can now read into how that dressing room would have felt like.
Yeah, man.
Because imagine Kai Havertz coming in and you're obviously much closer to a Chilwell and a Mason Mount. Because we'll get to the whole Tuchel thing, because Mason Mount gave a very funny look to Tuchel when Tuchel was talking to a player like that. Like, oh, Mount, man, shit's changed, bruv. But yeah, it's like, that Reguilón thing isn't... Wow. Oh, yeah. I didn't know. Yeah. I did not know that. Okay.
Oh, imagine Reguilón at Chelsea right now. Jesus Christ. But look, at the end of the day, Lampard has always set up to fail from the beginning. Because I don't know what in the club's mind thought Lampard would get us up for, or Lampard would lead us to a title. But Lampard drank the Kool-Aid as well, like all Chelsea youngsters before him. And results is what got these guys sacked. You know, results got this guy sacked. Because again, you read the story on how Tuchel got the job. I think Man City 3-0 was the nail in the coffin. I mean, we also Lampard after that game, he knew it was done. And the only thing that kept Lampard in the job was, look, Tuchel was the guy Chelsea wanted the whole time. I didn't buy all this PR that they wanted to wait for Nagelsmann and all this rubbish, because Tuchel almost got the job before Sarri came.
Why give him an 18-month contract, Eddie?
Huh?
Why give him 18-month deal?
It's pretty...
Scared.
The deal's quite weird. Yeah, the deal's quite weird, though, because apparently it's an 18-month contract with an option for another year.
That he controls, or that the club controls?
Any party can activate. So it makes no sense. It's pretty much a 2.5-year deal. Like, so... I think it's Daniel, I don't know if you remember this much. You know Jason Kidd and the Lakers? When the Lakers had the head coaching job available, Lakers wanted Jason Kidd, but there was this image of Jason Kidd out there to the media that's like, oh, domestic violence and all that bullshit.
Matt Barnes.
So what they done was bring in Frank Vogel and made Jason Kidd the highest paid assistant. So in the eventuality that Frank Vogel messed up, it'll be okay. We'll sack Frank Vogel, Jason Kidd, you take over. But everything got messed up because obviously we won the title. But that's what I think Chelsea.
Notice the picture behind Eddie's head, guys. This is where this example comes from.
It's Kobe Bryant.
Kobe Bryant.
Kobe taking the shot.
Yeah.
Rest in peace.
That's what I think Chelsea were doing here, because we all know Tuchel just got sacked. We all know the PR out there on Tuchel, that this guy beefs with the board. He's a great coach, but look, you're going to run into problems with him. So it's like, people know who we are, people know who you are. Let's just do an 18-month contract. I think he'll stay here for longer. If he's successful, I think he'll stay. But this whole PR thing was just played that, Chelsea don't want Tuchel. He was the guy he wanted the whole time, because Tuchel even said it. He said, I didn't want to come here until the summer. But I think after Leicester City, Marina went to Tuchel like, look, we let this guy stay till the summer. We have no Euro season. And there's no fans. There's no money coming in from tickets and all that. We need the money quick. So you better come in here if you want to coach a team in the Champions League or Europa League. That's if you want this job. And secondly, other people would be available in the summer, like potentially a Nagelsmann. But you didn't know how the whole thing was going to work. So I think he then decided after the Leicester City game to take the job. Which makes sense as to why Lampard got sacked after the FA Cup game. Because Chelsea were doing the whole work permit thing. Because I think there's a work permit process you have to go through. There's also the COVID process you have to go through. You can't tell me Chelsea did all that in 24 hours. Rubbish. So it makes sense why Lampard got the... I mean, potentially should have been sacked after the Leicester City game. But it makes sense why he got sacked after the Luton game. Because he was told to come in at 8 a.m. on the Monday he got sacked. Which made no sense. Because if you want me at 8 a.m. the next day, you might as well sack me now. So, look, at the end of the day...
Let me sleep in, man.
Exactly. But, look, at the end of the day, Lampard was set up to fail. I'm not even going to address the reaction to it because, look, I get it. But you can't... You're going to do nothing according to Conor McGregor. You'll do nothing.
But didn't he get smashed up by Dustin Poirier? So, you know.
Or Dustin Poirier, yeah. Nah, I'm referring to the old McGregor.
Oh, okay. Oh, the old corner when he was relevant. Yeah.
Yeah, you're going to do nothing. But look, he was set up to fail from the start. I get the reaction to it. My issue is, I mean, we'll get to Tuchel now, but...
Yeah.
My issue is where it boils over to Thomas Tuchel. Like, fair. Look, be angry at your boy at Chelsea that your boy Lampard was sacked. No, he wasn't given more time. That's your problem. I disagree, but hey, that's your cup of tea, man. Lampard's not here no more. I'm not going to beef you about that anymore. But my thing is, don't let it boil over to the new manager, man, because, yeah, he's a proper manager, finally.
I would like you to talk to me, man.
Sorry, guys. There was an internet outage in my place, and it was just been fixed recently. So that was the reason I went offline.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You're welcome, as I say. You're welcome.
So, want me to talk about Lampard? Like, we've been talking about Lampard for how many years? How many months now?
So basically, this is the angle I want you to ask. Just the reactions from online to him being sacked. The kind of people saying that, how can you sack a legend? The banners that were put up at Stamford Bridge saying that the rats have caught, sort of been the ones responsible for getting him out. So just the reaction from the media and online.
I was extremely happy when Roman sacked Lampard. I was like, finally, the degradation over my body is officially over. Now it's over, man. When the woman put that clue, when I woke up at 4 o'clock, I was like, because I have a Chelsea app on my phone. Anything ever breaking is exactly no. So when the app pop up twice, I was like, twice, what the hell is going on? So then I woke up like, let me go check what's going on. I was like, Lampard is sacked. I was like, Lampard is sacked. Are you guys joking?
Wait, can I just say, I would pay a lot of money just to have the video footage of Ablaki reacting to his Chelsea app waking him up.
Oh, man. The phone I'm using is my brother's phone, so he has two phones. So I get the second phone for me because my phone has been stolen. So I have a Chelsea app on it and all latest news. When the breaking was like, boom, I was like, pum, 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 what the hell is going on? And I check, Lampard gets like, are you guys trolling or is it a prank? And I went online with my laptop and I looked like Lampard is like, finally, Roman, you made the right decision. I was like, milder than ever. I was so happy. Like, finally, this man has to go. So people may hate me and say because no, Lampard is not good enough. I cannot be an apprenticeship manager taking up my job. No. I need an identity in my club. No. For the proper Chelsea fans, this is a manager just took over 24 hours. You guys are thinking you want him to win treble or he's getting sacked. You guys get the fuck out of here. You're not the proper Chelsea fans. Get out. You can't support Accrington FC or Luton FC. Don't support Chelsea anymore. No. You don't deserve to be a Chelsea fans. If you're telling me Thomas Tuchel is going to be given 25 hours to win you trebles, you all are crazy and mad. You all know who I'm talking, guys, the proper Chelsea fans. You all are crazy and mad. A manager just come in today and he took over the training tomorrow and you're telling him if he doesn't win treble, he's a failure. You two are a failure. In their life, all they do is to shit in an exam. You don't read for an exam, you expect an easy answer. It's not done in life. You work hard for everything. Frank Lampard did not work for anything. So it deserves to be sacked. It deserves. It's simple.
Didn't you want them to lose to Luton, though?
Yes, I wanted them to lose. So Roman will open his eyes and say, get out. Sack him.
But, like, You flipped, though. Now you're saying people who want the club.
No. I'm referring to the proper Chelsea fans who want to win the
tables. I'm with Abdullahi. It's like, you can call it hypocritical or so forth. Desperate times call for desperate measures. I wanted a mutiny. I said, anything that can be done to get this dude sacked, do it. So lose the game, through the game, mutiny, player power. Just get him out and start afresh.
These reactions... The club has too much influence on your daily life. If you're wishing mutinies and all of this stuff, like, it's too deep. It can't be that deep for you.
It's very... And basically, Daniel, is it so complicated that I can't say it's on the complicated Chelsea show?
No, I'm not going to lie. Yeah, that Luton game, I didn't start watching it till Luton scored.
Wait a minute, Eddie. You too. You wanted them to take an L.
Hey, I wasn't gonna watch that game, man.
He did. He just won't say it.
Oh man!
I'm disappointed. Lampard's gone. If I'm honest,
I did tweet that. Hey, Luton, I need to call in a favor on Sunday. So.
Yeah. No.
Because,
he has to go.
The funny part is, everybody say Lampard is no one hit Lampard. But for me, I say it's too early to be given. Lampard only has 1 year in Derby County, and you give him the job. You're setting him up for failure. Roman already made that mistake. I said it from day one. You made that mistake on giving Lampard the job. That's a big failure. So a new manager comes in now. Whether you like Thomas Tuchel or you like him, give that man a backing. Give him a backing. You can be a Chelsea fans in your heart, but don't say it out. Because a new manager can come and say you want him to automatically win a treble. Then, so you are telling me Lampard, you stay 10 and win a treble. If Lampard stayed there, we're finishing 15 or 16 in the table. But Roma said, I don't want that. I don't want to lose money. No. That was why I sacked him. I would have expected him to sack Lampard after the Arsenal match. Get out. After that, you should have gone. That's a London derby. You can't turn up in the London derby.
The Arsenal match would have been reactionary, to be honest.
So, okay. Let's, because I think, look, he's done. He's in the past. I think it's now time to look at the present and the future. So let's just talk about Tuchel. So let me just hit this. So from Rodrigo Rodersman, thanks for the dub. Lampard wanted Tarkovsky. Is sick in the head. I know. It is from the players that this dude wanted, this guy deserved to be sacked. He wanted to turn Chelsea into England 2.0. You sick psychopath. You absolutely psychopathic sicko. Sicko. Mm. King and Bani, thanks for the job. Marina has too much power. It can be good and be bad. I think we touched on that
last week, yeah.
It's not being sexist or anything. It's just being factual. My guy, super ego, you know, like Eddie, Blackie, our guy, Emenalo.
Bro, me too.
No, yeah, yeah. No. But I mean, Nigerian guy. So, guy is a football guy. So, it's. But obviously, Daniel perfectly explained why he's sort of left. But you need a footballing mind to be the director of football. Marina is a great businesswoman. She's not a football person. And you don't need a football person to make football decisions. But I have heard, since Lampard sacked us, I think Czech, they've now sort of, they've given a better definition of what Czech's role is. And I think Czech might have more influence.
For the director of football. He's been groomed.
Yeah.
To the
okay, so he's been groomed. But I think he's going to have much more.
Allegedly.
Oh my God. You guys are buying the PR again. That's what's been happening.
That's what
from
I'm
day
saying.
One.
Like, there's no. Like,
Peter Cech is a side. He's a side man, bro. He's
side piece.
Yeah, bro. He's being used.
Let's talk Tuchel, man. So look, let me just reiterate where I stand on Tuchel. So guys, no, because I want to talk Tuchel and specifically with the Wolves game as well. So maybe we could just combine them into. And I said this. I think I said this when we did the whole sacking. I said the best thing, my ideal scenario. The season is a bust. Is what it is. Lampard screwed up the season. Interim boss. Do a patch up job. Atletico is a freaking beast. So that's going to be difficult to get through with each of the managers. Season's a bust. Think long and hard and try and get the right man come the summer. Tuchel was not my first choice. Now, if it's between Tuchel and homeboy, I'm taking Tuchel all day, early day. But Tuchel, I don't think is a guy. Tuchel is getting sacked. This isn't a 3-4-year, 5-year thing filled with trophies. I don't think you're seeing that. You're going to see better football. You're going to see much more football. But I'm not sure whether it's going to be as successful as if you had given this to Allegri. And you give Allegri a summer and make him rebuild the team in his image. Or you take a risk on a Nagelsmann. But I think Allegri is maybe like the safer choice if trophies is what she wants specifically. But it is what it is. Beggars can't be choosers. Lampard needed to be sacked. There needed to be a manager in there. So, and you see, for me, I can walk with Tuchel. I couldn't walk with Lampard. I can't walk with the guy who wants England 2.0 and has no footballing philosophy. I can't walk with that. I can work with someone that has a footballing philosophy. That, okay, pros, cons, but at least you have a footballing philosophy. You are a manager and you're speaking a football language, not run hard, passion, work hard, and all that crap. So, 24 hours, he's had one training session. General idea from the Wolves game, just what I saw from Tuchel in the Wolves game, because I think this is even similar to when he was at PSG. I said that, okay, I don't think he can win it with PSG because it's a very pass-oriented system and it's very much about looking good and playing the game sort of the quote-unquote the right way. But I would say that, you know, for PSG, they need a Mourinho. They need like an Ancelotti. They need like a winner because you already have the players there. You don't need to focus on them having a philosophy. The players are there. You just need to give them that winning extra touch. So, as I said again, you can tell from the players' attitude, and we'll obviously focus in on Kovacic and Callum Hudson-Odoi. They can tell from the players' body language, they enjoy this and they're happy. I'm like, my God in heaven, for the first time, we're actually playing football. Because you could just see the smiles on their faces when they came out for the second half. But Tuchel, it is what it is. 100%, this is not going to be long term. I know how this ends. We know how this story is going to end. And it is what it is. So it's, I'm just here for the ride. But I am I'm happy to be on this whirlwind of a ride that will be Tuchel than I was with Lampard. Lampard was just, nah. But with Tuchel, at least it's going to be entertaining. I will be entertained in the whirlwind of wins, losses, draws, dramas, and so forth. But I think that it's going to be interesting to see what Tuchel can do with the players. Because just looking at that Wolves game, you're like, man, Chelsea have players. And if you get them playing the right way, a few more training sessions, the potential of the kind of football these guys can play, if they all come in sync, is scary. It is quite scary if you get all these guys in sync, singing off the same hymn sheet. This could be a very entertaining... That's the key. This could be a very entertaining team to watch. And see, Lampard was not interested in trying to work with this team and trying to actually make this team look like a good footballing team. But, and I think people have alluded to it, this was two, 3 weeks in the making. So I think Tuchel had been studying the team for two, 3 weeks. So be like, aha, I know what I want to do with this team. So by the time he comes in, yes, I've only had one training session, but I know every player very well, which is why when I look at the lineup, how much can we read into Mount being dropped? Because I think Daniel put out an interesting tweet. Was he dropped or was he rested? I want to say he was rested. But people jumped onto he was dropped because they can start their agenda. I say he was rested. And I think that Tuchel views Mount as a very important piece to the squad, not the central piece to the squad. And I think, as you saw, bro, Mount can be very helpful. But so, just to round up, before I go to Daniel, not my first choice. Not sure whether he's going to be that successful winning trophies, but at least the football is going to be much better. And this is something that I can work with a lot more with homeboy. Daniel.
Well, one of the things that Tuchel was known for at Dortmund and PSG was kind of being, you know how like Bruce Lee has like the be water? So like when you're in the teacup, you're in the teacup. When you're in the bottle, you're in the bottle, that kind of thing. Mm. Like that's kind of how I guess how Tuchel looks at management. So I'm not sure how fond I am of that. Like I'm more on the sorry side of the game where it's like, hey, this is, I play 4-3-3. That's what I do. So that's kind of how I prefer my manager to be. So the idea that, you know, Tuchel's going to be playing a back three every time, I'm not sure how accurate that is, because I would assume the kind of the scouts and just the people who are doing preparations to help Lampard would also have that installed for Tuchel when he arrives. And we know like when a team that's known to play back three or 5-3-2 or 3-5-2, however you want to say it, like when they play with that formation, the best thing probably to do is to match up. So you're not too outnumbered, and so the wingbacks aren't too problematic. So I would assume that that's probably Tuchel's thinking, is like, look, we'll just match systems. Hudson-Odoi at right wing back, I don't think that's going to be like a foundational piece of play. Not to mention, I saw a lot of people say, oh, Hudson-Odoi is going to be a right wing back, but, you know, out of possession, it's probably going to be more like a 4-4-2, and there's going to be a pendulum effect where Azpilicueta becomes the right back and Chilwell fills in at left back. So it's not like he's being asked to defend. Yeah. Although at the end of the game, there was a situation where he did, Hudson-Odoi, he did run and close down a shot that could have troubled Mendy. But yeah, I think Tuchel's just going to kind of adapt. I'm curious to see, like, watching basically every week, what are the foundational principles that appear in each of the systems that you try to use? So are there things that are Tuchel necessarily? So like this will always happen no matter how we play, we being Tuchel's team. Or is it just always kind of a new game plan tailored to whoever the opponent is? So that'll be the most interesting thing. But yeah, I think there is going to be more kind of tactical breaking down and just more interesting things afoot rather than kind of Lampard. And if you watch the Hudson-Odoi
post-match, yeah, I was just about to say that. Yeah.
He's also, I don't know if he knew he was doing or what, because he's young.
He knew.
Well, no, he's young. He's like 20, 21. So I don't know if he really understands like the phrasing. Or what, like, how he expressed himself would mean, but it's just like, instead of doing woo-woo, that's talking about Lampard, whether he understands it or not, which is kind of like, hey, man, like, this Tuchel guy kind of knows what he's doing. And the idea that, like, he probably, I would assume.
No. He knew. I mean, why wouldn't he know what he's doing? Because he just said, we are saying this instead of. Instead of can only mean, what are the instructions that you were given by the previous person?
I don't think he was consciously thinking of Lampard. I think he was just he was thinking of the way Lampard played, not thinking that this will sound bad against Frank Lampard.
But that's how people will take it. But he would have meant it like,
Yeah, like Lampard's football was obviously trash because of what Hudson-Odoi said. That's not what he meant by it, but that's the effect of it. But I could imagine one of Tuchel's first projects is Hudson-Odoi. Like, I know Dortmund wanted Hudson-Odoi. I know Bayern wanted Hudson-Odoi.
He played 90 minutes.
Clearly, there must be something in, like, the hierarchy of German football that likes something about Callum Hudson-Odoi. I don't know if that extends to Tuchel necessarily, but it seems as if it does. So, yeah, I'm curious to see how Hudson-Odoi improves with what seems, not even seems, with what is a better coach and a better manager. So, yeah, it'll be interesting to see what happens.
I mean, look, Thomas Tuchel.
Tuchel.
Just Tuchel. say to Chelsea to help you, bro. It's all
right. to Chelsea.
look, it's the perfect marriage. Like,
Demba, I mean,
HH said, I mean, on all levels, man, you have the six-letter word, you have Marina beefs with every manager, Tuchel beefs with every board. It works. And look, he might end up getting sacked, but for some reason, I've got this feeling that he'll probably outlast his contract. He might spend 3 years, 4 years tops here, I think. I mean, 4 years would be mid-season. In 4 years, yeah. So mid-season, he might get sacked again. But I feel like he'll do a good job. I look at the way he plays, and one thing that kind of struck me so far is the detail in which he goes into when he talks about players. That's something, like Daniel said just now, he's been studying the players for, I think, two. That's the thing. He's been studying the players for at least 2-3 weeks. I don't know if we watched the press conference last night. They asked him questions of specific players. The English media, you guys are sick, by the way.
Very sick and very unprofessional.
Talking about Chelsea youth players being Mason Mount and Billy Gilmore. I wonder why. Where the hell's Tammy Abraham? Where the hell's Rich James? The hell?
Complexion for the protection. Is it complexion for the protection for the selection? Or is it complexion for the selection for the protection?
It's called We Want to Protect Our What Boys, Boys.
What it's interesting because when Sarri was in charge, not to cut you, Eddie, but one of the repetitive questions for Sarri was, where's Hudson-Odoi? Where's Hudson-Odoi? Where's Hudson-Odoi? Now that Hudson-Odoi's there, they've switched it to where's Mount? Where's Gilmore? Etc. So I think it just depends on who's the kind of youth player du jour in that sense.
Oh, Daniel, did they ever pester? Did the journalists ever pester Sarri about Hudson-Odoi?
Yeah.
No.
Yes, they did.
I'll tell you,
No one
spoke about Hudson-Odoi until Bayern came to the picture. Simple. No one spoke about him till Bayern were like, we want that guy. And it's like, Bayern wants this guy. Why aren't you playing him?
I don't know if that's necessarily true.
The way it was phrased.
The future of Callum Hudson-Odoi was a present, persistent conversation.
The way that the journalist phrased it to Tuchel was, because remember, it was a lady, because I watched the press conference, it was a lady who posed the question, because she said about how Mason Mount is somebody who has been one of Chelsea's best players, he's really beloved by the club and so forth. Can he maybe reassure fans that he definitely has a future here? The way it was phrased, it was about how special Mason Mount is to people and people's fondness of him. It wasn't phrased in the same way with regards to Hudson-Odoi. Facto Mundilini.
The thing is, it's only one game, man. Like, Sarri wasn't getting questions about Hudson-Odoi after one.
Yeah. Not even like he told you before the game. He's like, this is the most unfair lineup I picked. So wait for my other lineups. But why the hell you asking him questions about Mason Mount? But hey, that's the thing for another day. But look, the detail he goes into when he talks about players, him talking about Billy Gilmore, him talking about N'Golo Kanté. Oh my God! Thank God for N'Golo Kanté. This guy can finally play some decent ball, man. I love when this guy said he is a double six. Simple. Double pivot. Thank you very much. None of this lone DM crap that we're seeing on the setting managers. And another thing I've looked at over the last couple of days, looking at his previous squads, he likes to have a big squad. Something Lampard didn't like was the fact that his squad was big. He wanted maybe 15, 16, 17 players he could just micromanage. But Tuchel likes to have options. He likes to switch between formations within games. Generally has the same philosophy. I think that's what Daniel was trying to find out. I think he has the same philosophy of, trying to keep the ball, trying to be direct. But again, at the same time, trying to take out what your opponent do best. So that's something I think we'll see with him. He'll mix it up between a back three and a back four. I think the back three was just for that game. I don't see him playing a back three consistently. But what you see is, like Daniel said before, back three principles. So it might be you play Rich James, and instead of him playing right back, he's more right center back, or Benchu. I think Benchu or more. Another thing you might see with the fullbacks we have, is them playing more inverted. Because when I see what he was doing with Callum Hudson-Odoi yesterday, and people were saying he played right wing back, I don't think Rhys James is as direct as Callum Hudson-Odoi. I don't think Ben Chilwell. Oh Jesus, Ben Chilwell. That guy is pretty much.
Please. I beg.
To have a Marcus Alonso conversation,
guys. Look.
Brick door winner by the way.
No one come for me. Yeah.
Wait a minute. Was there a Brick door 2020?
I can't remember. I need to check.
There wasn't.
No, Kepa.
Kepa, was it Kepa? I mean, it should be Kepa, but I don't know if there was a ceremony.
Yeah, no. I need to check. I don't think there was. It's a good point. I don't think there was, yeah.
No, but...
So Marcus Alonso is still the reigning...
No one say shit to me, eh? But if Marcus Alonso played yesterday, Chelsea win that game. Simple.
If you're playing with wingbacks, there's a place for Alonso. If you're playing with fullbacks, then this guy needs to be barber,
scholar,
an online salesperson, teacher. Like, he shouldn't be a footballer if he's playing as a fullback, but as a wingback, hey.
That's why I say, this guy's rotation, Tuchel's rotation, the fact that he'll use these guys in different ways. That's what I like. And what you see is these guys improve tactically. You see your Rhys James Emerson's third.
The water's poisoned with Alonso, man. The fans are poisoned against Alonso. Would be the right thing, they'll still say play Chilwell. Alonso's name is Alonso.
I think Daniel is right in the sense of, and everyone knows this, is that Alonso has his uses.
Yeah.
If Alonso in a back four having to defend is treated as trash, he's got a wing built for him. Put him as a wing back and give him less defensive responsibilities. The guy can be helpful for you, because Chilwell was horrible.
he was bad, man. He was bad. Nah,
like,
but
that chance, if Alonso was in that position, I don't know if he scores, but he does better. I'll say that.
I was actually watching it live at the time. I was like, oh no. I saw it before him. I was like, oh no, HH doesn't want to see this, man.
No, because do you know why it annoyed me so much? Because I was like, my gosh, if that goes in, who gave the assist? Who is the guy that people have been hounding on?
Havertz.
It would just be...
No.
Havertz was the guy that put it on a plate.
Bro, that's a... Look, okay, well, I'll get to some players, but I just want to finish on Tuchel. Look, Chelsea fans need to be excited, man, because I think if you wanted a manager with it, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, but this is the one Chelsea manager in the last how many managers we've had that's got a track record of youth development. Like, if Chelsea were really into youth development, this is the one manager. I don't remember any other managers, not even your AVB. AVB just wanted to play youth because the team was older. But if you're talking of a manager who actually is invested in youth and wants to improve youth, it's Tuchel. So that's why I call it a perfect marriage, because I feel like you'll see this guy stay at least 2-3 years, in my opinion. So, look, Chelsea fans need to be excited. HH.
And before Abdullahi goes, the one problem would be, what if he decides to develop the youth that they don't want developed? So what if most of his attention goes to Callum Hudson-Odoi and Reece James and whomever else, but it doesn't necessarily go to the Gilmores or Mounts of the world?
Then
that will create a problem, because the media, obviously, and the fans themselves, if we're honest, prefer
just say it.
They prefer a particular kind of development.
No, okay. In my opinion, I don't think Mourinho really cares who he develops. I don't think Mourinho really cares what the media think of. Because, look, this is the first time Chelsea were the media darlings. Like, before the Lampard era, Chelsea were one of the most hated clubs. I mean, HH, correct me if I'm wrong. But in the media, Chelsea were one of the most hated clubs. You guys bought the league, you buy players, you don't develop.
That's what
Chelsea was.
Basically, what Chelsea were was like what Man City are. Hence why Pep Guardiola answered that way when he was asked about Lampard, because the English media were like, you've just this Russian guy who's just foreign, who's just come and just bought the league and so forth. They don't have the tradition and the heritage and all that crap.
I speak in code.
I mean, at the end of the day, he will develop players. If he develops Tino Angerin over a Mason Mount, you guys don't have a problem. If Chelsea win a league title, are you guys going to care who he develops? No. We don't care.
Yes,
you got us a title.
Yes, they will, because Mourinho won league titles, especially the second league title he won, and people still call him trash.
Yeah,
why didn't you develop Oscar? Why didn't you keep Mata? Why didn't you develop Salah? Why didn't you develop Lukaku? Why didn't you develop De Bruyne? So people will give you shit even if you win the league, trust me.
People constantly revise shit, bro.
I know.
It's annoying. They all forget the fact that Mourinho got rid of these players and built squads that won 2 Premier League titles and I think 1 or 2 Europa Leagues. Are you guys going to talk about that? Because you all wanted to win trophies. And this is something I've asked players. Are you willing to see 3 to 4 years of Chelsea winning nothing to develop youth? No. Shut up.
I know one person who isn't.
Okay. So, let's bring him in, man. Okay. So run off and then.
Yeah. I don't know if I'm running off yet because I seem to get on.
No. Keep going, my friend. Keep going.
So look, Tuchel, it's a perfect marriage. He's got a track record in youth development. He'll improve the squad. Look, as far as beefs with Mourinho, we don't know. But getting on to the Wolves game, what I saw, look, first thing, I think I posted this on the group chat, counter-pressing. My goodness. For all you pressing merchants who will talk about Mason Mount pressing, now go watch that game and watch how you press. It's not one guy running around. It's a collective thing. It's creating overloads and winning the ball back, blocking passing lanes, cover shadow, all this stuff. Freaking talking about Mason Mount and pressing. Get out of here, man. The lineup, I didn't have a problem with it. I don't think Mason Mount's a bad player. The guy just needed a rest, man. If Mason Mount didn't play yesterday, I think Tuchel knew that if Mason Mount didn't play yesterday, he will get so much criticism from the media. Mm-hmm. That's why he put Mason Mount with 7 minutes to go. I don't think he wanted to play Mason Mount yesterday because
let me ask you this then. Honest opinion. What role do you think he has for Mason Mount in the team?
That's something I was going to get to. I think Mason Mount, Kai Havertz, and Hakim Ziyech will have similar roles in this system as the two tens. Similar to what he did yesterday, who play instead of the half spaces, get free roles and all that kind of thing. That's what. So for those of you who are stuck on positions, just forget about positions, man. It might look like Mason Mount's playing left wing, but he's really not. He might have a free role because you look at the game yesterday, Kai Havertz and Ziyech, they were just popping around, like trying to find
everywhere, spaces, everywhere.
Come deep, go there, go. I mean, yesterday was Kai Havertz, easily Kai Havertz's best game in the Chelsea jersey. I don't care what anyone says. I know he's got the hat trick against
Nottingham Forest.
Brexit FC. I know he's got the hat trick against them, but yesterday was the first time I really watched this guy and I'm like, okay, now this guy can really do something. And another guy who really annoyed me yesterday, I know no one got on him as much, Olivier Giroud and Tammy Abraham. Man, these guys were poor yesterday, man. These guys, seriously, these guys were poor.
So would he have brought on Werner in place of Giroud as the striker?
I like the fact that he dropped Werner because Werner is someone I've been calling to drop for a while. But yesterday, there were situations where there was a through ball that Havertz put in that I think Olivier Giroud just gave up. If that was Werner, Werner gets there. Like, easily. That's another thing. We played through the middle more a bit yesterday. I think I saw the most through balls I've seen in 2 years in Chelsea.
Because see, people's criticism was like, oh my gosh, sideways. Because I wouldn't watch the match again, but when you watch the matches, like, first of all, you're going up against a low block, a very defensive team. But you could see how they were trying to break things down. But when the sensor is so congested and you've only had 24 hours of training, the team lacks chemistry. Because this is a total 180 of what you've been doing for the last 10 months.
That's why certain players had life. I mean, you saw Kovacic. Kovacic was bouncing around
yesterday.
Oh, my God. Hudson Odoi. This guy looked like, I nearly cried when I saw this guy taking on Nuri. I nearly cried. Because, under Lampard, this guy would pass the ball and run or, like, do some rubbish in space. But this guy going directly at a wing back. My God, HH. It was beautiful to see.
Because he knows. Because he's already. The funny thing is that he played 90 minutes. When last did Hudson-Odoi play 90 minutes?
Exactly. Like, if that was Lampard, he would have taken out. He would have taken out Havertz and Hudson-Odoi.
For sure. That's the normal thing, you know.
So look, certain players have life now. I did say that certain players will have life. Jorginho has life. But I think it's a Kante Kovacic double pivot with Jorginho coming in as a backup. Rudiger, look, he had his chance yesterday. I don't expect to see him in the lineups. If we're playing a back three, I think expect to see more Christensen as much as we hate it. Look, it is what it is. But the striker, I think Timo Werner will end the season as Chelsea's main striker. Because the way Tuchel's teams play, what's that, Daniel?
That's an L.
Nah, Timo Werner ends the season as Chelsea's main striker because I think the way Tuchel's teams play suits Timo Werner. I mean, it's a German style of playing anyways. It suits Timo Werner to a T because, I'm sorry, you know, there are some things that I saw yesterday that if Timo Werner played that game, he'd probably take. Mason Mount even created a chance for Tammy in the 90th minute. Like, how are these strikers stopping on? How do you stop on a run when you know the ball's going to be whipped in low, hard?
And remember and that chance in the first half that Callum did for Giroud.
That Mount normally goes for the cutback, and Abraham knew that. So he tried to stop for the cutback. So I understand why he stopped. Obviously, in hindsight, you could say keep running and you're there at the near post. But how many times have we seen Mount do a cutback and Tammy's there on the penalty spot? So I think that's what he was thinking. So yeah, I'll give you a pass that one. Giroud wouldn't have stopped.
He's a near post merchant. He's a near post merchant.
Yeah, true.
Quickly. Go ahead. What was I going to say? I just let the thought go. Kovacic and Jorginho. Are we gonna have a segment on them?
Yeah, yeah, we will. Okay. Yeah, we are. After this, yeah.
And okay, just so I stop rambling about players. I think we've done. He'll utilize the squad. I think everyone in the squad will get opportunities. So look, it is where I think Chelsea will do bits this season now. Top four might still be on the cards, but I think we'll finish fifth or sixth. I think we'll finish fifth or sixth, but top four race is back on. I want that FA Cup now. I want that FA Cup now. Well, I hope Gatlock's not watching.
Look, like, let's hope he's not watching, man.
Semis minimum.
All right. Abdullahi, talk to me, man. Tuchel.
We finally have it.
Wait. Very quickly. What's are on those post-it notes?
Which one?
Post-it notes on the wall.
The one on the wall.
I used to it. Those are my reminders, calendar.
I've been wondering that for 3 weeks, but I just haven't asked. It's not my business.
Because when I do, like, when I read, I have a post-it note, like, so when I forget something, I decide to go back and check.
No one tell me to be easy, man. Semis minimum. I don't care.
Look, Eddie, be very careful with it on that semis minimum thing. It's going to hurt your ass, man.
When you have a proper manager who knows what he's doing, it gives you motivation and joy. When I listen to Thomas Tuchel speak, like that excitement in my face, I was like, wow. But when I look at Lampard's face, I look at depression all over my body. Depression. From day one, it's depression. Lampard will keep talking, and the player like basic, they like this. And I'm like, okay, like basic. And I look at the training pitch and I shake my head. Like basic. All I see that, what they do in training is run, shoot. And I question Lampard, when you tell them to run and shoot in training, why are they not doing it on pitch? You yourself have to be questioned as the manager. If you're telling me this player have to be, I see those clip, they shoot in the training ground. They shoot and they laugh. Hey, winners, come to the pitch. All I see is run, maximum, bam, bam, to Reece James, to Benchiwe, boom. They don't, when they not cross, you can cross and have a striker who head goes. You cross to Pulisic and Timo Werner, and I start laughing like, we are screwed up. Pulisic and Timo Werner, and you have a 6-4 on the bench. That was when I said Lampard literally doesn't even know what he do. What he's even doing at all. But when you look at the Wolverhampton one, I know we didn't score, but you can see, everybody can see a pattern. You can see Cho playing, Kai Havertz playing, even Jorginho looks so better in that system. Unlike Lampard, he looked class A, class B. Class A, class B. Jorginho, Kovacic, how both of them, the way they interchange, that is beautiful to watch. When I look at Tuchel, the way he's talked to the player, I call them in. I want you to do this. You got to do this. You have to do this. Know this. Do this. They listen because they buy into his ideas about what he wants to do. That is a manager who knows exactly what he wants to do. Exactly. Like, yeah, this is a manager. Oh, I want you to do this. I have to do that. Look, if you look at Cho was talking, see, all the way the manager wants us to do is attack, attack, attack. Go on the byline. Please, can proper Chelsea fans tell me, when has Lampard come out and tell players, you must cut to the byline? Can someone just tell me that? When has Lampard said, I told them to do this on the byline, they do it. When has Lampard said that? No. All Lampard said is, give it to Chilwell or Reece James and shoot. That's what I do. Exactly. Odoi will be on the bench. Lampard will play Mason Mount. I was like, and I look at Lampard like, what is going on? He's probably in form. No. Like, I need to go on to that proper Chelsea fan. Those guys who doesn't have their eyes.
Talk about Tuchel, my friend. I asked about Tuchel, my friend. Okay, what about this guy? We will talk about Lampard. Talk about Tuchel.
Okay, that's what they say from the start is, when you have a proper manager who knows what he's doing, he gives you happiness. Like, the way, there's a difference between a system and a philosophy. Tuchel is a philosophy manager. And when you see him kind of coach the players and kind of coach those players, you see happiness. I keep asking the question, there's a difference between coach and a manager. A coach will literally coach a team entirely to make them, a manager will only interfere into the transfer and manage the team. That's the difference between both of them. Thomas Tuchel is a coach who's going to coach all those players and make them look better. A coach, Ousmane Dembele and Christian Pulisic, who you write to love, with the hoots literally Dortmund just gave just kind of the boycott Barcelona and give my Barcelona player 170 million for Ousmane Dembele. Who coached him? Thomas Tuchel. So that's why you know a good coach, a proper actual coach who knows exactly what he's doing. If Ousmane Dembele was under Lampard, I can tell it's going to induction. Scholar. Because you'll be telling Dembele to back cross and cross and cross. So there's a difference between both of them. There's a difference. So coming in now, Tuchel calling is a breath of fresh air. This is
so how much do you believe in him? Do you think he can be the right long term man, or do you think, like me, he'll eventually get sacked? Does the Tuchel tenure look like?
I think it could if it's successful in Chelsea, like the way he's working and the players buying into the formation he wants to play, I can see him staying 3 to 4 years. Very possible. Because you can hire a manager and tell me after 2-3 years you sacked him. What are you telling those players in the team? Like someone like Timo Kai, who signs a very long contract. What are you telling them? So you're not portraying a good long-term process into the player, putting a short, just want to know. You have to build something for a long term. I'll be manager who the player can relate to and have that kind of unity joined together with. It will make them feel like Liverpool as club. Clark has been there for how many years now? The same with Guardiola. So when you have a manager who the players can trust, even if they're attacking players outside overseas, who's your manager? Thomas Tuchel, I want to go there. Because of why? Because he does this, he does this, he does that. He gives other players happiness. That's it. It could stay very long. And this is it to all Chelsea, to all proper Chelsea fans. Leave Thomas Tuchel alone. Guys, leave this guy alone.
They won't leave him alone, man.
Leave him alone because you guys are waiting for him to fail. So when you fail, you're going to be like, see, Lampard did this, Lampard did that. I don't want to hear any stupid and idiot thing about Lampard anymore. He's gone. His era is officially over. His era is over. Get him out of the door. And Roman already did that. He did that and get him out.
Quick question.
His era is...
Nah, I finish up lawyer. I'll ask a question after.
Okay. His era is done. Now is the new era of Thomas Tuchel. Now everybody needs to support Tuchel. It wasn't my first option. Mas Allegri was my first option. Because I know Roma will not hire Mas Allegri. I know. So now Tuchel is here now. We all have to give him our backing as a fans. Let's be united back. Let's just be united. I don't want to be hearing, and if he doesn't win this, we sack him. Are you the manager? Are you a woman? If you're not going to support Chelsea Football Club, get out. I can't support.
Forget those guys, man. Don't mind them. Yeah. Foolish people, idiots.
Nah. I mean, look, it was finally refreshing to see a manager talk about proper tactics instead of, you know, the players didn't run hard enough. There was no desire to win the second balls. Remind me where you heard that before.
It's just so refreshing. Oh my gosh, a guy's talking about tactics.
This guy's talking about breaking the lines. This guy's talking about going in and out. This guy's talking about inside forwards.
Yeah.
This guy's talking about taking on defenders. This guy's talking about breaking down low blocks.
No. I think the key thing was the biggest thing was Hudson Odoi. Like,
yeah,
I've never seen him look so happy before, because he was like, man, like, because you could just it just makes sense. I told you, forget the media. Why would Bayern Munich go in twice for this dude? Why are they going twice for this dude? And Tuchel, in his first game, has played Hudson-Odoi for 90 minutes, giving him pretty much two roles for the game. So it just shows you that, just from perception, eye test, he's like, no, this kid is something. And this kid is going to be my, and obviously we'll get to Hudson-Odoi afterwards, but it's going to be my pet project. So I want to talk, I want to move on to Kovacic and so forth.
Just before we go on here, because I just want to get the whole Lampard thing out of the way. Who gets credit for Hudson-Odoi playing? I mean, in terms of managers, who gets credit for Hudson-Odoi?
In what sense? How do you mean?
So, a certain manager brought him to the team. Another manager played him. And now, who gets credit for Hudson-Odoi at Chelsea?
Sorry.
Cool. So, Conte is one who gave him his debut and, I mean, let him known to Chelsea fans and all. But Sarri is one who played him. If Tuchel makes or improves players like your Mounts, your Tammy Abraham, your Rich James, who gets credit for him? Because Lampard. I feel like proper Chelsea fans will tell you,
if Mount ends up being one of the better players in England, then Lampard will get credit for that, and rightly so.
How about Rich James and Tammy Abraham?
James will
James will be Lampard, I think, as well.
So, okay, quick question to all of you guys then. So, do you think that under Tuchel, Mount is going to make that massive level step up quality-wise? Like, he'll improve him dramatically?
I think his game will improve now more so than it would under Lampard. Lampard had his best intentions at heart. So I will play you until you can't run anymore. Mm. And that will be my version of developing you. Just making sure that you're in the team and you get the minutes that you need at the level that we are, meaning Chelsea. Tuchel will improve him. He might not play as many minutes, but I'll bet you his game will improve based on the kind of the education and just the style of play that Chelsea will implement. So I don't know. It'll probably be like 50-50 over the course of the next 18 months, you know, and we'll see. But.
Okay. So let's go on to this cover thing. So from Mr. Dean Classic, thanks for the dub, who says...
Have you brought the guest you want to bring to him? Are we going to finish
No. I mean, let's see. I will bring him on after this segment. So it says, Dean Classic, Ed, how does it feel to hear peeps call your bro Tims?
Man?
Is that in reference to Lukaku?
Lukaku, I think.
But he wasn't called Tims. That was just a joke that I cracked. So,
thanks for the job, man.
Yeah, I mean, like, that was just a joke that was cracked.
You guys are gassing Kovacic.
Who, me?
Yes, you guys.
Okay, no, okay, let's talk about it. Let's talk about it. So, Kovacic, man. Now, look,
Is it Jovacic, where they play together?
Yeah,
Jorginho and Kovacic, Jovacic. Yeah. You guys are gassing Jovacic.
Okay, so here's my thing.
It's not it.
Forget Jorginho. Here's my thing. Jorginho ain't it. Jorginho literally cannot breathe. I saw
today he's going to be up for a contract extension, though, have hope. So just keep that in mind.
Okay, fine. But here's my thing.
Yeah.
Here's my thing. Let me land. You see, I think it's Jorginho.
They want to extend Jorginho and Silva.
See basically, Jorginho is Sarri's father. Jorginho is Sarri's son. You know, so... Jorginho cannot breathe.
Jorginho is Sarri's
mouth. I cannot live without Sarri. Here's the thing about Kovacic. Now, to reiterate, I haven't played every position in football. That is a false narrative, okay? No. My main position was central midfield. That was my main
position. I feel like I've heard you say you've played every position at
this
point.
No, I have not.
Goalkeeper?
No. No, okay, the goalkeeper, I played for one game.
So that counts.
No, it doesn't. 90% of the time, I play central midfield.
If you've played it once, you've played it.
Okay, I played three positions. And that's it.
I heard you say that you save penalties in the penalty shootout.
Okay, keeper, yes.
So, the...
Keeper, fullback, striker, midfielder. Fullback? No.
Center back?
Nope.
All right, well, okay.
Yeah, there you said it. So thank you. so basically, central midfield was my main position. So
winger, I've heard.
Nah, never.
I've heard that.
Well, we had wrong, bro. Clean the wax out of your ears.
No. It was your run story.
No, that was rugby.
Oh.
That was rugby. That was rugby. Ugh, scary. what's it called? So whenever I look at football games, because central midfield was my position, I focus more on central midfielders, you know, because that's the position that I played the most. And here's the thing about Kovacic. You have to know what you get from Kovacic and what he is. Because in a midfield, I think that the perfect midfielder, you have roles. There is what I call the metronome, and then the guy that breaks from midfield. You know, you must have a metronome and a guy that breaks from midfield. Javi was Barcelona's metronome. Yes, he made a few forward passes. How many times did Javi carry the ball from midfield? How many forward passes would Javi make? That role was for Iniesta. Iniesta was the guy that broke from midfield, who was the guy that really connected the midfield to the attack. So Iniesta and Javi were a one-two punch. Javi, the metronome, Iniesta is the guy that then breaks and is the connective tissue. The issue that you had was Kovacic and Jorginho were doing similar things. Whereas that you really just needed one guy to do that thing and another guy to be the guy that now breaks. So basically it was a weird formation that Tuchel went with, because really, in a sense, the guys that are breaking from midfield, you could say, was Ziyech and Havertz, but really those guys were much further up the pitch. So for Kovacic, from the game that I saw, he was the guy that was really dictating play and was looking, when he could, for those forward passes to a Havertz or Ziyech. But obviously, against like a deep block, it's going to be very hard to get those passes, because once you get those passes through, you need to be very quick with it, with a 1-2 to be able to offset the congestion that is against the opposition that you're playing, who are now going to defensive. So you now have to go wide, 1-2-1-2, go wider, and so forth. So my thing is, I can understand the criticism that people have of it's too many sideways passes, or the passes are not going forward enough. But you have to bear in mind that this is one game. So this is a one training session. And I'm hoping that Tuchel can see this and say, okay, this is a great foundation to start off from. I can now see Kovacic is far more comfortable here. And I now see how good he can be on the ball. Now, similar to what Pirlo said to Arthur, bro, get that ball forward. Move that ball forward. Take more risks. So Tuchel can now say this to be like, Jorginho, thanks, but rest on the bench. Kovacic, boom, and I know how good you're on the ball, but let's now go on, walk into training, and I try and create a better understanding with Ziyech and Havertz, because those are the guys that are ahead of you in the middle of the pitch. So we're now going to training and try and create situations where you can now find Ziyech and Havertz into those pockets to try and create some cheddar in the sense of the pitch to now generate a through ball for the striker or for Havertz and so forth. So my thing is that the foundation is there. It was never going to be perfect. So now the thing now is take more risks and create an understanding with a Havertz, a Ziyech, or even a freaking Mount, because a Mount is another guy that can play in the half space. So that's where I am with the whole thing, is that, look, I knew what Kovacic could freaking do. I knew what Kovacic could do, and I knew this guy was a baller. So when guys were saying, oh, there's a reason why he was voted best player for Chelsea last season, because I know what this guy can do. And it was obvious that under homeboy's tutelage, dude was like, what the heck are we doing here? But under Tuchel, he can already say, aha, you're speaking my language. You're speaking my language here. And you can see Kovacic feels far more comfortable here. So we know how much homeboy loves Kante. It's now about how this is. So the key thing is Kovacic Kante, where I believe Kante sits and Kovacic now breaks. So it's about allowing Kovacic and enhancing Kovacic's name to be the midfielder that breaks from midfield and is now a connective tissue with the attacking midfield. Daniel,
yo,
hit me with your rhythm stick. Well, pause. No, I was quoting a song, but I never was like, oh my god, what the heck? But yeah. Oh god, yeah. Now rethinking those lyrics. Oh, what the heck? Oh yeah. Yeah.
All right. Okay. So I think you hit on a couple points. Number one, Jorginho and Kovacic are too similar. And that shouldn't be the case, because Kovacic is clearly a better footballer than Jorginho in terms of what he can do on the ball, his ball retention, all of that. Like, he's a better player than Jorginho is. And I mean player just in terms of footballer. So the fact that they essentially do the same thing, for me, is an issue. Now, I can understand what Tuchel was trying to do. I think the main focal point of this team yesterday was Callum Hudson-Odoi. So if you know that Wolves are going to be playing kind of compact, you know, with a bank of five, then a bank of four, maybe even two banks of five with a goalkeeper behind, the wide areas are going to be where the space is. So Callum becomes the focal point, and then you have, you know, maybe the front three was, someone remind me, it was Giroud,
Hudson-Odoi.
No. It was Giroud, Havertz, and
Ziyech.
You have each one of those three. Well, Ziyech was trying to find pockets of space in between the lines. Then Chilwell, the other wing back, would then be on the back post. Giroud would be in the middle. Basically, Tuchel wanted to put as many people in the box as he could, so that way when Hudson-Odoi beat a guy, if he put in a cross, like Chilwell got really close to one, Giroud got really close to one,
yeah.
And Havertz was doing his own Havertz thing, right? But so Havertz was filling the box. So what happened was, is when Wolves were just very compact, you had Jorginho and Kovacic just kind of passing it sideways. They weren't really driving the ball forward in the opportunities that existed for them to drive the ball forward, because they were just happy just to keep it. I'll pass it to Chilwell. I'll pass it to Hudson-Odoi. When Azpilicueta or Rudiger stepped up, they were happy to pass with them. So it's the idea that it makes sense that if the tactic is to get the ball wide and just fill each area of the box with a person who can meet the cross, all right, cool. But what happens when that doesn't work? And obviously, as Half Hope said, it's only one day of training, so obviously you probably haven't developed the steps that you'll need. Okay, if plan A doesn't work, here's B, here's C, here's D, etc. Like, you need those multiple things. So what I wanted was Kovacic. You and Jorginho are basically doing the same thing. But as I said before, Kovacic, you have more ability than Jorginho does. So let Jorginho do his little, just keep the thing fluid and pass it. And he can do that along with Silva when Silva decided to step up from the central center back position. But Kovacic, when you get the ball, drive with it. Go forward with it. I don't need you to score. I don't need you to assist. But I need you to beat one player to break the Wolves line. That way you can get the ball to Ziyech in a pocket of space, who can then turn and do something with it. And that's been my issue kind of with Kovacic his whole time, is that, and somebody told me, go watch Kovacic at Inter Milan. So I did that kind of before we started. He would get the ball and just drive with it. He would get the ball and he'd run, beat players. He's not a goal scorer. He's like a pre-assist merchant in that sense, that he'll get the ball to the guy who's the guy that will then make something happen. But when I watch Kovacic, it frustrates me because I see the ability that he has. I would love for you to do more. Now, obviously, Half Hope on Twitter, you brought up, is that instruction or is that choice?
Mm.
We can't know, because maybe Tuchel was thinking,
which he does for PSG.
So perhaps it could be instructional, but you had 90% possession. I mean, that, like, the little thing on BT Sport was like 96% to 4%. I was like, Wolves aren't trying to hurt you. Wolves are in their own crisis, as it were. They're just here for a point. So they're not trying to hurt you, really. If they could, they would, but they can't. So just take a few risks. It was very risk averse. It was very safe. It was very basic. The reason that you... One thing that really annoys me is, like, in Champions League games, Neymar will get like, yo, he turned over possession like 20 times, and people on Twitter will be like, ah, he's a brick. For when I see that, I'm like, he's clearly just trying to dribble. He's trying to do things. He's trying to create. And when you do that, you'll make mistakes. The fact that Chelsea were able to pass, like, how Kovacic had a record number of passes and a half, or Jorginho had this record number. The fact that you can keep the ball for, like, literally in 10 minutes, you have the ball for like 9 minutes and 30 seconds of that 10 minutes. That's not good, because that means it's just too safe.
And just
everything is too, like, what is the most simple thing we can do? And it's just pass it back. You need somebody who's, and I think I mentioned this earlier today. Now, I don't think Chelsea have this player. I'm not saying that.
Hazard.
But someone of this intent, in Ndombele from Tottenham, when he gets the ball, if there's not a simple pass, he's like, all right, fine. He does his little moves, and he'll beat you, and he'll just drive the ball forward to get the ball to whoever the striker is or the forwards are, and then they can create something. So, so personally, Conte is the... And this is the weird thing. You wouldn't think this. If you look at Jorginho, Conte, and Kovacic, you wouldn't think Conte is the one who will drive the ball forward when given the opportunity. But he is. So that's kind of where I want to see this thing go.
But then quickly.
Jorginho drops out. Conte comes in. And Kovacic can do what Jorginho was doing yesterday. And Conte is the one who then takes the ball goes forward with it.
But then, quickly, to your point, though, because Tuchel did say in his press conference, because he talked about Kante, and he used the word water carrier in terms of Kante, which means that I don't think he's going to do what you're trying to say that you're saying.
But see, I think Kante is smart enough to know then I'll just do that anyway. That's what I hope. But anyway, now the players that I know can do this, unfortunately, one is at Aston Villa. His name is Ross Barkley. One of them is at Fulham. His name is Loftus-Cheek.
Mm.
And I think that might be it from midfielders who I kind of just trust to just take the ball and beat somebody.
Yeah, drive the ball forward.
Because Mason Mount, no. He's not beating players necessarily. He's another one who will look for passes necessarily. Or he won't even be in those positions because he'll be competing with Havertz and
Diaz
to find pockets of space. And it was really interesting, just lastly, if I could round this up. Jorginho, in like the 88th minute, decided, okay, instead of passing it sideways, now that we need something, I'll find one piercing pass. And he did, and he found Mount. And Mount kind of spun, and that led to the chance that we talked about earlier where Abraham, if he kept running, he could have gone. People looked at that, and they said, Mason Mount. That's why Mason Mount should be in the team. It's Mount.
Nah.
Who got the ball to Mount? It was Jorginho, who finally decided, for whatever reason, let's just try to find a vertical pass.
Mm.
And that's what the team needed the whole time. If you're not going to drive the ball forward with your feet, then find the pass that's vertical. If that's difficult, which it seemed to be because Wolves aren't stupid, then you need somebody in there who can create by themselves. That's like the Pogba type of player in my mind. It's just fine. I'll just dribble you, and that will create the space.
Danny, I think Timo Angel and the youngster can do what you're asking of to do that. In terms of Dr. Sheik and...
he's more of back, a winger, if, though, Abdullah.
No, it's a box-to-box midfield. It's like a carrier from the midfield.
He's a 10 or a winger, Abdullahi. What the hell?
Now people are saying Bakayoko. I mean, I would try it, but the well's poison for Bakayoko at Chelsea, so I don't think he's coming back. But, yeah. That's a glaring issue in the squad that Lampard just decided... Or the club probably decided more so than Lampard. Let's just send Barkley and Loftus-Cheek elsewhere. Thank you, Double S. But
is what it is. So before I go to Eddie, see, this is what I always say about possession. Possession is the most overrated stat.
Yes.
Because my thing is that it's not about how long you have the ball. It's what you do with the ball. And I think the issue is that as a manager, you need to be responsible enough to enforce your players not to be too comfortable with possession, because for players, if you're on the pitch, you love that possession thing, and it's a false sense of security. Comfort.
Yeah.
And also a false sense of security, because it's about what you do with the ball. I can show you many games where a team has had 78% possession and they've lost the game because the team with 20-30% have just known how to use the ball. So I think that what I hope Tuchel takes from that is that, okay, cool, kept the ball and so forth. We now need to just take risks. Because see, this is what
build
I always say.
Build upon it.
Yeah. It's similar to what Daniel says, that don't lose the ball in our half. Lose the ball up there. Because the theory of dribbling or trying things is that you can make 3,000 mistakes. All you need is just for it to pop off once. Because it popping off once could lead to a goal. And that's it. So make the mistakes and so forth. Lose the ball. But keep trying and trying, because hopefully, law of averages, you create space and then you can now lead
really,
to a goal.
It was just really comfortable for Wolves to just sit in their shape.
Yeah.
Because, we just sit here, the ball will go wide, and then they have their center backs and whatnot to deal with the presser. So, and just for Abdullahi's sake, like, a player on my mind that does this is Grealish. Grealish gets the ball in midfield. He'll come deep. He'll collect the ball in central midfield, and he'll beat players. And
he's looking for that key pass.
For like the Ollie Watkins and the whomever, the John McGinns or whoever these players are that you wouldn't even think, oh, they're good. But it's easier for them because you have a player in the team who beats guys. And that's kind of – if you're going to buy English talent, instead of Declan Rice and James Tarkowski, save that cash and go get a Jack Grealish of the world, somebody who can beat players, because that's what you need. Or – you have Loftus-Cheek. You have, Barkley on loan. Go get them. And I was hoping, okay, if Kovacic and Jorginho aren't going to do this, maybe Ziyech should drop deeper to get the ball and then he can go forward with it. But obviously he's trying to find his pockets of space. Havertz obviously has his mission. I need you to fill numbers in the box. So he's not going to drop and come collect the ball. So it was very vanilla. So when I saw people, oh, Kovacic had a great game, I was like, yeah, he kept the ball well, but there's a reason the game was 0-0. I'll shut up now.
Eddie.
Look, the Chelsea thing is what it is, man. Yesterday's game wasn't going for me. Jorginho should not be sniffing the first 11. I think, like Daniel's saying now, he'll get life, but this guy's going to be frustrating. Oh, my. I will never forget the Liverpool game last season. My guy was, he was diving worse than Kepa, bro. To reach, who was the man that beat him on the counter? I think it was Robertson. Oh my God in heaven. The thing with the game against Wolves was, I think the first half had shades of Sarri ball, with a little seasoning of cross and inshallah. I think things improved in the second half. I mean, if you watch the game, that's what it was. The players were kind of doing things that they were familiar with. And I think they went into the dugout and at halftime, Tuchel's telling them, look, do things better and this is how you can improve. That's where we started to see a lot more low crosses coming in the second half and a lot more through balls. Like you could see, I think Ziyech put out Tsunodoy, I think, through like three times in the second half. Ziyech came a bit more deeper in the second half because, I mean, I think Tuchel saw what Daniel is pointing out now, that we have two guys sitting down, sitting back in midfield. We need numbers up front, but you guys aren't going up to make those numbers. So Ziyech, you come back, see if you can pull a man with you and put the ball through for Hudson-Odoi. So
that's why I wanted to see Pulisic a little bit earlier, because he's another one who's the best dribbler in the team,
The subs were perfect, but it came in late. That was another thing. I mean, he went into. I think I was crying for it in the 55th minute or the 60th minute. But
I said 65 is a nice number.
I think especially, if you have Conte in the team, you'd be more willing to risk kind of an offensive play. Yeah, but because you don't have that in the team, you need those two guys to do the job that Conte. But
the thing is, what was Chilwell doing all game? You could have put Pulisic on earlier. Like Chilwell was dead. Like, that guy can't beat a man to save his life.
Where's Alonso, you know when you man? Said, give me Marcus.
You know when we talked about 0-6?
You know how bad you have to be for me to want Marcus Alonso? No,
like, on the other wing, I'm watching Hudson-Odoi beat a man, go directly at a guy. I'll watch Chilwell, I'm like, do something!
Boneless, like, skinless awful, chicken breasts.
Awful.
He's a boneless, skinless chicken breast.
Boiled potatoes with the skin.
Boiled chicken, no seasoning.
Boiled potatoes with the skin on.
Oh, let the guy live, man.
Boiled potatoes.
In terms of how Chelsea play, I think this guy said it. He said I've always wanted Conte in my team, and I think to the point Dana just made, that's where I was actually going to. Now with Conte in your team, you're more willing to take risks. Because I was kind of mapping something just now. If Chelsea move to a back four and we have the two sitting in there, I mentioned something before on inverted wing backs. And I also mentioned that, you know, this guy plays with three at the back principles. Supposing he uses Kante as the guy who sits deeper in midfield, deeper with the defense, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
So he uses
DM.
DM, right? Kovacic is supposed to be the guy who breaks the lines with his runs and stuff. I don't want to see Mason Mount there. I don't want to see. It's nothing against the dude. Before people come for me, yeah. Mason Mount doesn't have the game that we need.
Stop being defensive, Eddie.
No. Because I know people are gonna come for me that I don't like Mason.
Nobody said anything.
I already said Mason Mount's position with this guy is gonna be in the 10, like further up front, because the way Mason Mount's game is more suited up there than building up from the back. If you put Mason Mount at the back, you're going to see this guy lose possession. I mean, didn't he play DM against Leicester City as well, like with Kovacic? You also saw how that worked out. So I don't want to hear stuff about Mason Mount and DM. If Chelsea were smart, and I think Daniel tweeted this out yesterday, and I nearly cried when I saw it. If Chelsea were smart, you'll get yourself Loftus-Cheek back into this team.
Terminate the loan.
Can we do that?
Yeah, you can do it. I mean, it's not a good look. It's not a good business look, because then people that you want to loan people to will be like, well, this team will cancel a loan. So it's not a good look business-wise. But if you want the team to flourish, go get him.
Loftus Cheek.
Exactly. Because as much as the Kante Kovacic thing works, the way I look at it is, if you're taking the player away from the midfield, he's going up front to make up the numbers as well that we lack, especially for teams that sit deep. We already have four players there. You might send maybe one of your wing backs and let the other wing backs sit deep with Kante. Whoever you're sending forward needs to be able to do something, man. Like Kovacic, I'm sorry, he can drive the ball from midfield. HH, what are you doing?
Hey, I'm engaging with the audience, man.
Kovacic can drive the ball up front, yeah. He can drive the ball up front, but again, when he gets up there, what is he doing with it? Like, if you're just going to dump the ball off to your Ziyech or your Havertz to do something, I'm sorry, people are just going to let you have it. Like, they'll do what they do to Jorginho. Keep the ball, you're not going to hurt us.
Yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah. Just, you're going nowhere.
That's why, short term, I think the Kante Kovacic thing works. But if you really want Chelsea to say what's up in terms of attacking sense, you go get yourself a Loftus-Cheek. Because imagine building from the back with a Kante, Loftus-Cheek driving the ball, then you have your Havertz, your Ziyech, your Pulisic, and Hudson-Odoi is ready to
So, are you saying, is that 4-3-3 or 4-2-3-1 with Loftus-Cheek?
4-2-3-1 with Loftus-Cheek.
And Loftus-Cheek is the number 10?
He's like an 8.
He's your
box-to-box 8.
Yeah. Okay. Oh. And you have Havertz in the 10. You have, say, a Pulisic, Hudson-Odoi, or Ziyech out wide.
Oh, no, I thought you were done, so I was going to go.
Just quickly, Corbin Garrison, I think this is obviously like a pro thingy guy, man. Just say that you will be banned, but here is your little thingy, man, then. So I think he's an All Lives Matter guy, so I just wanted to put that out there. So, continue.
But, so, look, that's what I think he'll be. You can't judge too much on what happened in the Wolves game, because one, the quality of opposition we're playing were not that great. They were just trying to counter us. Yes, that'll be a lot of the teams, but when I'm assessing what Tuchel does, I'm assessing how this guy will fare against, you know, the Tottenhams, the Arsenals, the Liverpools, the Cities and all. So that's why I said I don't want to see Jorginho in the team. But just rounding up now. The guy to bring back is Loftus-Cheek, but for now it's a Kante Kovacic thing, and we'll see how it goes. So you might have the KKK back in midfield. Kante Kovacic Kai.
It fits.
It works, man. So look, that's what I think it will be till the end of the season. And then you can maybe throw in Billy Gilmore there once or twice, but hey,
Billy Gilmore.
I mean, since they want to throw him in our faces, man, that guy needs to develop as well. So that's what I think he'll be. But hey, it'll be interesting, because I think looking at the people, if we play four at the back and you play Chilwell, play this guy inverted, man. I don't want to see this guy up front anymore. Like, he's done. Like, he's good. Just play him inside the half space, whatever. He can useless. Help defend and all. Another guy who will be good for the inverted wing back for you Chelsea fans who have been crying for Reece James at CDM. This might be the chance he gets to play that inverted role in midfield. Because if you go look at, I think, Pep's Bayern, he did something similar with Philipp Lahm. Who was the other wing back there?
Bayern or for...
For Bayern in
Alaba.
Yeah, I think he did the same.
Yeah, Rafinha was right, Alaba was left, and Lam was in the DM.
Yeah, but they were pretty much playing inverted as well, like sitting back and letting the, you know, more advanced players do the work. So that's what I think something Tuchel might try with this system. So look, I'm keen for it, man.
I would like you to talk to me, man. Oh, you wanted to say something real quick?
It's real quick. Who would you guys say have been the best back three teams, let's say, in the past 5 years in football?
Oh, now, Juventus.
Now, I would say Juventus, and I would say Chelsea with Antonio Conte.
Yeah.
Now, the key of this is, if you are going to play with those two number sixes in midfield, you need somebody who has vision, passing range, players like a Bonucci, ball-playing centre-back who's really, really great at ball distribution. And I know I bring this guy up damn near every podcast, but let's do it anyway. David Luiz, who has great passing range. Chelsea yesterday, because Kovacic and Jorginho were so risk adverse, if you had a Bonucci in his prime or Luiz in his prime instead of Thiago Silva in the middle, perhaps he could find the ball to Callum Hudson-Odoi, a Ziyech, or what have you. Even with Sarri, when he was playing 4-3-3, David Luiz was one of the only people who was willing to try kind of these expansive, just kind of how or why would you think of that? And, you know, 8 times out of 10, it didn't come off. But those 2 out of 10 times that something actually positive happens is good. So I think if Tuchel is doing that, I think what Eddie said earlier, where Christensen coming into the team will probably be a good thing because he is probably the best ball-playing center back that Chelsea have at the moment. So having him in that middle to be the – obviously he's not as good, but Bonucci, Luiz, that would probably be more advantageous than –
pray for set pieces.
Than Thiago Silva, who again was kind of just with the safeness. I'm giving you guys examples. It just so happened that the example was David Luiz.
I think Thiago Silva can do something similar. Again, yesterday I don't think there were specific instructions, and there were no spaces behind for him to exploit. Anyways, yesterday Wolves were so deep. Yesterday it was actually bad.
But there's always that ball over the. There's always that period where you can see that ball over the top.
But
always.
You only play balls. You play balls over the top if the defense comes up.
No.
The back four when they're going nowhere.
No.
I'll be back.
Okay.
Obviously, like that. Those are the easy ones to see where the ball goes in the air and it goes 50 meters, and you're like, oh wow, what are you doing? But just like the piercing passes between the lines.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Like Jovacic, they didn't do that too often. They were just happy to pass it around. Like they did it, I can remember once or twice, and the one was to Mount that I already mentioned. But
all right,
yeah.
So
you need visionaries if you're going to play like that, and they didn't have any yesterday.
So let's bring in, because our guests have been waiting in the background. So I want to just get these guys in, as we have some special guests who just want to just give their thoughts on this man. So let us welcome Nippon. And of course, Ak. So,
Ak.
Okay.
Hello, guys.
What's up? Aloha, welcome. Because obviously, I think Abdullahi is preoccupied. So, Nippon, just talk to me about that game, thoughts on the game. So, thoughts on Tuchel, how Chelsea look, and thoughts on Kovacic, and just the general play. Are you happy? Unhappy? Just your general thoughts on that first performance against Wolves.
I see some improvement. I think Havertz is starting to show what he's capable of, what he was showing us at Bayer Leverkusen. And Timo Werner, even though no end product still, but what do you expect? You've just had 24 hours and one training session.
Yep.
And I guess a draw is really good if you're facing a team like Wolves.
So I mean, like, are you happy with the approach? Because we obviously talked about, you know, Kovacic and Kante being the double pivots and everything. So in terms of what Tuchel is trying to make this team do, keep the ball, the possession, 4-2-3-1. Do you prefer that, or do you still want that 4-3-3?
A pivot. The thing is, I agree with Tuchel when it comes to changing.
To be honest, Tuchel will be.
Let Nippon run off. I'll come to you. So.
So yeah, when it comes to changing formations, I actually like what Thomas Tuchel does. Like that makes it more unpredictable. Did you not see what he said in his first press conference as manager?
Yeah, no, I watched the whole thing.
So yeah, I rate him for saying that.
So, you know, because, so, and do you feel, so let's say, looking forward to Sunday, do you feel that he's going to put Timo Werner back into the team? And if he puts Timo Werner back to the team, do you think he puts him as striker or at one of the flanks?
Striker, come on. We have a proper manager now who knows what he's doing. Lampard needs to go to Scotland for the championship.
Thank you, my man. Thank you. Somebody said it. Somebody just said it. Fine. My brain is off.
Hey, listen to me. I don't know if you're listening to this, Rory. I like you, but your Lampard obsession is killing me.
No. Yes, it's shots fired. No, that Rory thing was wild. So let's bring an Ak, man. So Ak, your thoughts, man, on the performance so forth.
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
It's refreshing to have a manager that can actually coach, bro, on the sidelines. Yeah, not like Lampard, bro. Like I saw that Rory guy, innit? I've got pictures of him, bro. The guy's a xenophobe. I've got pictures of what he said, innit? It's refreshing. I think Jovicic is our best pivot, but the thing is, Kovacic, I'm not sure what he's doing. He should be dribbling a bit more. I remember Inter Milan, he used to beat players, used to do loads of stuff like that. I think a player we need is probably I think Tuchel's looking at Marquinhos for some reason, DM. But other than that, yeah, I think 24 hours, he had one training session to do, innit? And he drilled in the passes. He's already connected with Hudson-Odoi. I could tell Hudson-Odoi is his next project, I think, that with the Oost at Dortmund. That's what I think, bro.
So, and do you, so looking forward to like Sunday and so forth, because at the same time, so it's a thingy. Do you think Timo Werner is going to be introduced? And if Timo Werner is introduced, do you think he's going to use him as a striker or use him as one of the flanks?
I think you go for two up front, Havertz and Werner, bro. Because
what?
Havertz is a number nine? No. If you want to go for
relax. He's got a point there, man.
Oh, no, but I think
I heard
like
Ragnick talk about Havertz. He could play as a target man. I've heard Ragnick talk about it. So I think two up front could work. I don't know, bro. Okay. I see Havertz.
So if he's saying two up front, are you saying literally like two strikers or more of like Havertz is a bit behind? So basically like Henri Bergkamp.
Yeah, that's something like that, yeah.
It's more like a shadow striker, second striker role, man.
And it makes sense. My thing, like, why that makes sense is because you can tell that in Germany, they have an understanding. Werner and Havertz. So because they have an understanding from Germany, maybe if you get them playing together, closer together, they can maybe be able to create a chemistry to maybe create some stuff to pop up.
There was something similar done yesterday where Havertz was trying to play with Giroud. Like, it's not like it's a bad idea. It could work. How many times did you see Ziyech and Giroud combining yesterday? Not very much. Havertz combining with Giroud, Ziyech combining with the wingers and the wingbacks. That's what it is. So it could work.
And for me, Havertz is more of a goal scorer. He's more in the box. I was baffled when Lampard played him as a number eight. He's not a number eight, man.
No.
Oh, yeah. Wait, quick question. Because HH, I don't know how you dismissed this when he said it. So, and you let this guy live with this, man. Ak.
Yeah.
What makes Jovacic our best pivot?
Can you explain? At the moment, with the players we have.
Hold on. Where does Kante fit in this whole equation?
Obviously, as a double six, I think Jovacic works good, but I don't know how Kante would work with Kovacic, obviously, but right now, what I see, it's a good pivot, but I get what you're saying with lots of cheap.
Okay, what makes it okay? Why do you think, from what you saw against Wolves, why do you think Jorginho Kovacic is a good pivot? What makes it
pivot? Kovacic, I expected him to drive forward more, but I don't know why he wasn't doing that. That's the only thing I'll say. I'm thinking if he drives more, then you could see potential, but I get what Eddie's saying, innit? If we brought Loftus-Cheek, Kante back, I think. Well, Daniel was saying Bakayoko. I'm not sure about that one, bro.
No. I was reading
Bakayoko. More like Bakayoko.
No.
You see, he played one season injured, and now everybody calls him a brick.
Yeah, look.
Like, you guys are very disrespectful people.
You guys need to go watch Bakayoko at Monaco, man. That guy was a beast.
Look,
like,
I know what, he's the only one like that.
He had a loan at Milan. Milan wanted him. He had a loan at Monaco. Monaco wanted him back. He's now at Napoli. Napoli wants him. So
yeah.
Okay. Actually, let me bring in. I hardly didn't really speak before. I'm like, talk, man.
You're on mute.
I've been listening to what everybody said, and I think I listened to what Tuchel said in his press conference that he wants to use 2-6. So he said he wants to use 2-6 now. Then I'm watching. How does he play Conte? Is he gonna play Conte Kovacic or Conte Jorginho? Because playing Conte Jorginho, it doesn't work. That's a failure because we know how it's too slow. If we are losing possession, Just, I think the two pivots they're gonna use is Kovac, Mateo Kovacic and Conte, because like what Daniel said, Kovacic can be the one kind of playing the ball, and Kante can do the one doing the like what the rest are gonna get is in that PSG where you do those dirty work, that kind of Marquinhos, Baratti doing the passer running, then it is gonna get the dirty work, interception from the back and passing the ball. I think that's how he's gonna use N'Golo Kante in Chelsea. Maybe it's gonna allow him to do the dirty work. The Mateo Kovacic could be the ball carrier, but in the summer it will be okay to get a ball carrier. Someone like you haven't met, I don't know if you rate him very well. Asim Awa. Asim Awa is a ball carrier. Asim Awa is a ball carrier. It's very good.
Wait. Let's move on. Abdullahi.
I think Asim Awa is a ball carrier. It's like when you play Conte Kovacic, you could play Conte and Asim Awa together. You'll be the one doing the number 8 pivot. And just look at it, let him do the defensive interception. But that name makes me think of something. Loftus-Cheek. That is where Loftus-Cheek comes in. That's where you have Loftus-Cheek, boss to boss. He has the agility, he has the energy, and he has the physicality. So I think this is where Loftus-Cheek will fit into the system. At this moment, we're stuck with the midfield that we have. Maybe in the summer, if those players come back into the team, that is when Thomas Tuchel will sit down and look at the variety of player we have. Then that a decision will be made. I can see Barkley getting sold. Very possible. Because if he comes out of Chelsea, if he doesn't get a chance playing, it's going to be a problem. He wants to send Aston Villa. So that depends on what the board and Tuchel themselves are saying that, okay, what do we do going forward? Who's going to be my number? Someone that's going to say beside Conte. Because we have Kovacic, Jorginho, Loftus-Cheek, Barkley. We have 4 midfield. When you include Bill Gilmour, making 5. So, out of those midfielders, at least 2 has to leave. 2 has to go. Because the manager can't play the 5 midfielders together. It's not possible. So, 2 midfielders to leave and 3 has to stay. So, it's all about, it depends on the decision-making between Thomas Tuchel and the board entirely. How they decide. If they decide very well, it depends. That's why I made mention of Asim Awa. Because Asim Awa is a very technical player. He can go from the midfield and pass and also shoot, because we lack a player who shoot from the midfield.
So okay, what is your ideal setup specifically from midfield to attack? What would be your ideal setup if everybody is available?
I'll play a 4-2-2-2. 4-2-2-2 will work because I'll play Conte Kovacic, then I'll play the 2 in behind him will be Christian Pulisic and Ziyech. Then in the 2, I'll play Kai Havertz and Timo Werner together, because Kai Havertz has in height. Is very, very tall. In terms of set piece, he can score and say he's very tall. So that will work for me, because Kai Havertz can play as a shadow striker to Timo Werner. So if you want to build a connection, you can build a connection between the both of them. It's going to work.
Because so you're dropping Giroud and Tammy.
Automatically, Giroud is leaving in the summer. Tammy does not know how to use an head. Don't even mention that. I don't have a striker. No. I don't want a striker who can score from his head. That's not a striker for me. It's not a striker. So I want someone who can score goals. And that's when Bernard can score with his head.
That's what I'm saying. Allow Tammy Abraham, man. Like, I don't want to get our players too hard after that game, because the only player I got at really was Ben Chilwell. I mean, he was bad. But the thing is, that was the first game under this guy, man. Let's see how they improve. Let's see how much tactical instructions he gives them, and how they improve with those instructions. Because let's not forget, we're watching these guys after 24 hours. Some of these guys have a lot more to their game than they should under Lampard. So let's not just write things off like, oh, Tammy can't score with his head. Aubameyang wasn't a great scorer with his head before coming to Arsenal. And this guy was banging in. Go check his record under Tuchel. This guy was banging in goals at Dortmund. So Tammy can still come good under this guy.
This is the problem. This is the problem. If Tammy's our number 9, we can't go forward. That's the problem. That's what I say.
No. But the point that Eddie is making is that this is a new manager. Mm-hmm. Who knows what he can do with Tammy? That's basically because initially I was with Abdullah saying that, like, Tammy, nah, I ain't feeling this old dude. But what if homeboy comes in and can help bring in something to Tammy's game? You know what I'm saying?
You are very right. But I'm looking at the news. Roman wants to spend money this summer. And the player they want to send money on is Erling Haaland. If Haaland comes in, Can someone tell me where Abraham plays? I want to know.
Alan's not sniffing Chelsea this summer, bro. Yeah.
He's not sniffing exactly. To Chelsea, you, my friend.
People,
who said
people need
that?
To get smart. This guy has a 75 million buyout clause that's not activated to 2022. What makes you think he'll be available this summer and your Man City's don't go for him, your Real Madrid's don't go for him, but all of a sudden Chelsea have all this money they want to throw at this guy? It doesn't happen. Chelsea have other areas they need to fill first before going at the striker again. So spending, 50 mil on Timo Werner this year, you want to go spend another 100 something? Because if you're going to get Haaland this summer, you're talking of spending at least 100 to 120 mil. Simple. Because you want to bring this guy in earlier. It's not happening, man. I don't know where you guys are getting this from.
So I understand, but I cannot trust Tammy to be my number 9 for next summer because Olivier Giroud will leave in summer. We're going to be left with Tammy Abraham and Timo Werner. Now, where do we go from there? Because in terms of Tammy, I don't really trust him that much. And Timo Werner has not been informed. So that's my worry and my problem going forward. That's what Thomas Tuchel will have to improve those players together.
Werner is not going to stay out of form.
What
if Werner ends up with 20-something goals this season?
I mean,
He's got nine.
Eddie, I'm willing to bet you 5 kobo. I'm willing to bet you 5 kobo that Werner's not going to end up with 20-something goals this season.
You guys should bet some Manscaped ball toy.
Look, I'm telling you right now, Werner could end up with at least 20 goals this season. Like
all comps for the league.
Huh? All comps. All comps is got about 9 at the moment. I can see him scoring another 11. Especially if Chelsea go find the FA Cup. So I don't know what the thing is.
End up scoring even 1.
Okay. Let's go around the room on this one, man. Let me just hit my thingy. So on Homeboy, on Werner, this is going to be the last one before we get out of here, man. Timo Werner, see, my thing with this is it's make or break now. I think that under Lampard, it just wasn't popping off. I think if you don't make things pop off now with this new manager, then I'm not sure how much hope there is for your boy Timo Werner. So my thing is, what do you guys think Timo Werner is going to do under Tuchel? My thing is, Timo Werner was the one guy who you can't really blame Lampard for stuff that he were doing. You can blame him to an extent, but at the end of the day, you had opportunities. You didn't have chances. You had 1v1s and you didn't put them away. You can only blame Lampard to the extent of, I don't think Lampard maximized your strengths, which is that you're not good on the ball. You are good in transition and you're good where your speed can be used in order to get in behind the defense. But you receiving the ball to feet at the halfway line and now being forced to now carry the ball, that into you. You're not a guy with balance. You're not a guy that can carry the ball or beat a man or a guy that can walk in a tight spaces. There has to be a situation created for you rather than you creating that situation for yourself. So if Tuchel maybe can understand that and put you in the best possible light, I think there is a chance for Timo Werner to hopefully, because again, it is what happens. Look at Liverpool today right now. How many games did Mane and Salah go with missing? Sometimes it just takes that one game for you to find yourself and then you can now start hitting the back of the net. So I think that if Tuchel puts Werner in the right position, I think there is a chance that he can do pop off. I still don't see him as a high volume striker. I know you guys said that 2020 something goals. I don't see that, but maybe I'm wrong. So Daniel, where do you stand with Werner under?
I don't know Tuchel well enough, and I don't know Werner well enough to add both of them together to give you a solution. So I'm on kind of a wait and see kind of thing.
Edward.
Look, like Daniel said, it's obviously a wait and see, but based on what I've seen with the former strikers that he's played, I mean, you look at your Mbappe's, his goal scoring record on that Tuchel, you look at your Aubameyang, you look at even Neymar as well, you can add to the list, Marco Reus. This guy loves strikers with pace. And the key thing you said, HH, is this guy depends on, situations or chances created for him. instead of leaving him to create the chances himself. A lot of the times under Lampard, you were seeing this guy coming deep to get the ball, to get involved in the game. If the way Tuchel plays, it's more, you know, chance creation. It's more getting everyone involved. And all he'll need Werner to do is pretty much play close out to the defensive line, try and find the runs, and we'll find you. That's the thing people, you know, miss about the Lampard thing, where this guy was making, but people didn't find him early. Yes, I mean, you're still not going to forgive the fact that this guy's first touch is bad. This guy's finishing has been bad for a while, but he just takes that one chance to see the ball go into the net, and I think he'll be successful. I'm saying minimum 20 goals this season. I'm going on that. Minimum 20 goals this season.
I doubt that. I highly doubt that.
I've liked it. Werner, talk to me.
Limo Werner. It's tough, Richard. It's tough, man. It's tough. Can I trust Tuchel to improve Timo Werner? Very possible. But the problem is, we need to see Timo Werner score. Timo Werner has not been in form. Maybe that's the reason Tuchel doesn't want to bring him immediately to the team. Want to give him time to relax, to watch matches, to kind of get himself together as a striker, then to start scoring goals. At this moment, I'm in the middle, because if Timo Werner starts on Sunday and he keeps missing sitter, who do we blame? Do we blame Lampard or do we blame Tuchel? That is a big problem. So at this moment now, it needs to be eased into the team. Maybe second half, bring him in 60, 65 minutes. Let him play. Let's see Timo. But I believe that's what I want Kai Havertz and Timo Werner to try, because there's that connection between both of them. I look at the world of everyone, that's some true passes in which Kai Havertz was giving us. If Timo Werner was there, I can guarantee he will score at least one or two goals in those passes. That was what I want, those combination between the both of them to work. That's my issue. I want it to work. With Timo Werner gets confidence back, surely. But we just have to wait and see. We can't just based on one match, we have to give him time to see. Maybe 5 or 6, maybe a month or 2 months. Then we can revisit it back and see how we improve his Timo Werner at the moment.
Ak?
Yeah, earlier I said Havertz and Werner up front. The only hope I'm clinging on to is Tuchel's German. So hopefully he can get something out of him. But I don't really know. But hopefully, I think he's a confidence player. And the thing is, he's a counter-attacking striker as well. So I'll just have to wait and see, bro.
Nippon?
Yeah. I think he can improve on the Thomas Tuchel.
How many goals do you see him having? If you're to take an estimate of how many goals at the end of the season?
This season? 15 max. I don't see him scoring 11 more goals this season. Possibly in future seasons, but I just don't see it this season.
Okay, so...
Look, man, all the doubters out there, your boy Pierre-Emerick Aubameyang, he had a horrible, horrible first season in England. I don't know if you guys remember that. He had so many brick performances.
No, but didn't he hit the ground running when he came to the Premier League for Arsenal? I swear he did.
Came in January, either, right?
Where he did from?
Yeah,
what are you on about?
The moment that I remember he came in January, and like literally, it was like, wow, Jay, look at how quickly he scored goals
in his first season.
No.
He came in January. This guy has been scoring goals since he came in. What the hell?
I'm thinking of someone else.
15 goals in half a year. I remember him coming in and.
Thierry Henry.
But remember, you see, Henry.
Remember, he was 21 when he signed for Arsenal.
Mm-hmm.
Like 6 months without scoring a single.
But no. That's disingenuous, really? Because remember, he came in as a winger from Juventus. And that took time for Wenger to then change him from a winger to then a striker. So literally, he was not even on anyone's radar back in the late 90s.
They played him at left wing back, I think.
Yeah, so I think like...
That's the same thing Lampard did with Werner, always playing him on the wing.
No, but I'm saying that Werner started at Leipzig as being one of the most proficient goal scorers in Europe, which Henry wasn't at Juventus. So I think it's like a false equivalence based on what they were in their previous clubs before coming to this current club. So guys, look. So let's just hit this off. So throwback picture, man. I'm going to throw this up, man, for you guys, man. Throwback picture. And I want your thoughts on this when I pump this up, man. So just look at the picture and just give me your thoughts when you see this.
Better not be Lampard.
in my opinion.
Bakayoko.
Andre.
Board versus manager once again.
Wait. One at a time. So, Daniel.
Board versus manager once again.
Explain that. In what sense? How do you mean?
Mourinho didn't want Shevchenko, but Roman Abramovich wanted Shevchenko, so he bought him Shevchenko anyway for, I think the fee was 37 million, which was a record at the time. And Mourinho had to force him into the team, and that led to the deterioration of their relationship, which led to him leaving the first time. So it's one of the more primary examples of the board having probably undue influence in the acquisition and acquiring of footballers.
Okay, my thing was, I knew Shevchenko was already on the decline at Milan, but something in the back of my mind said, what if there's still some AC Milan Shevchenko left in this dude? Even if I knew that, see, it was my heart versus my brain. My brain was telling me that, why would Milan be so ready to let go of him? But then my heart was saying, but look at what he did. Maybe if you bring that Milan into Shevchenko, and it is still Shevchenko, he can do something. But I think that it was obviously a case of like him and Abramovich are mates, and he came in there just to get
a freaking payday. He's the first Torres. He's the first Fernando. Like, it's the same thing that happened with Fernando. Basically, I don't know why Abramovich... Do you know what it is? Mourinho wanted Drogba at the beginning, but nobody believed in Drogba. That Drogba was going to be good enough to be the striker to lead the project. But Mourinho was like, nope, I played against him when it was Porto against Marseille. This is the guy I want. And ever since then, basically, Shevchenko, Torres, you could go through a whole list of strikers that they tried to get rid of Drogba with. So Shevchenko is one of the list of strikers who was bought to basically get rid of Drogba or challenge him. But he basically beat everybody until 2012. And now he's the legend that everybody remembers. But Drogba was a very frustrating player week to week. Like, people remember the finals and stuff. So I can kind of get why they wanted Shevchenko, and he's a fancy name or whatever it is. But, yeah, it's just board issues. That's what I see when I see Shevchenko, in blue anyway. I'm done.
Anyone else? Thoughts? Shevchenko, Chelsea.
For me, Daniel said it, innit? It was the same as Torres signing, because he was declining, and Torres was declining at Liverpool as well. I think his season we bought him, he was injury prone, and he only getting 10 goals a season. Like, Torres' only good season was the...
He scored the most clutch goal of our Champions League.
Who?
Torres. Remember when he sent Gary Neville into a frenzy?
That wasn't a clutch goal.
That was the most overrated goal.
That was the last kick off the game.
Ramirez should get credit.
Yeah, no, but if he hadn't scored that, Chelsea would have still gone through. So it was sort of like all right, thank you, Barca. There's no chance.
I thought that was a must score.
No. Like,
it was 2-2 on aggregate, and Chelsea had an away goal. So
yeah,
I didn't know that.
Yeah,
and the curse of the number nine as well, because majority of our number nines under Abramovich have been flops. Only two stand out, like Drogba, Costa, maybe Anelka. That's mine.
Costa wore number
19. I don't know. No, Costa never won number 9.
I think he just means the position of striker, not the number. Strikers,
Sorry, I thought you meant the number.
All right, man. So, actually, let me just hit some of these things that I missed. So, from Dungo...
Eddie, were you not around during the Shevchenko days?
I was, but he was bad for Chelsea, man. Like, I remember Shevchenko more for what he did at AC Milan than what he did at Chelsea.
He didn't do it. No, he scored one quality goal against Tottenham. Yeah,
yeah, exactly.
And that's a damn good goal.
That's why I'm like, the only thing I was gonna say is, why does HH give us like all these bad ones? Like,
I know, give us a good memory, man.
I like bad memories because it's.
I like bad memories. Gatlock, clip it.
HH, when will you give us Drogba, please? We need to remember something. This one is a flop.
I like.
Like, I mean, next week is probably going to give us Lucas Piazon or something.
No. Next Kezman.
Next week's going to be Steve Sidwell.
No. Next week's going to be Mattia Kezman.
Oh, boy.
give us Lumba, I beg.
Give us Mutsu.
Bellotti. He goes through the list of Chelsea flops and he's like, yep, these guys.
Winston Bogart.
All right. So wait, let me hit some of these things. So from Dungu Kamal says, that's the only KKK that I want to see on my lawn. Oh, damn. Bloody hell. Jesus.
I think it means Kai Kante.
No. Yeah. Obviously, I don't know. But yeah.
I don't think anyone's that crazy in this chat.
Yeah. Wait. So, and Rodrigo Rodas says, it's understandable why Tuchel played safe yesterday because it was his first game. I believe he wanted to see how to implement the counter-pressing. Yeah, look, as I said again, look, my hope is that, you see, Burnley ain't an easy game, bro. Because Burnley, yeah, these guys, they beat Liverpool at their crib. So Sunday's game is going to be interesting.
It's a good step up from Wolves, and I say step up in the sense that Burnley are going to be more defensive and they're going to be more dangerous on the counter than Wolves were, because Wolves didn't play any striker until whenever they brought on Willian Jose. They didn't have any strikers. They were just trying to hit Chelsea on the counter and see what happens.
No, because see, what I want to see is a team that gives this Chelsea team a little bit of space, but also a team that tests this Chelsea defense. Because Chelsea defense, they literally had nothing to do. They literally don't do any defending.
That's going
to
be Spurs.
That's going to be Tottenham.
Yeah, the Spurs. Yeah.
Well, it's because we just saw from Mourinho, this guy attacks for 10 minutes and then says, okay, 80 minutes, we're just going to
lose. That's the point. Be injured as well, isn't it? Harry Kane might not play that game now, isn't it?
True.
Harry Kane is Jose just confirmed it. He's not going to play against Chelsea. It's out of the Chelsea match.
So that game is what? On Wednesday?
On Wednesday, yeah. It's out of the Chelsea match.
No, the game's on the... Is it Wednesday or Thursday?
It's on Thursday.
I think it's Thursday. Yeah. It's on Thursday.
How long is his injury for?
Jose said maybe 2 weeks. Maximum 2 weeks.
Did he get in time for the Euros?
Oh, no. He'll be there for the Euros. So, guys, thank you for tuning in, man. Remember to like, subscribe, you know. Look, new era, new day. Shout out to the proper Chelsea fans. Shout out to that loser or agent, whatever your hell is. Thank you for...
Check guy's neck, man.
Guys,
he's a xenophobe, man.
And also, shout out to Ak and Nippon who have come for our guests. Thank you, bros. Thank you for coming on and sharing your thoughts.
I hope you let me come on soon, have hope.
Nip one. On your hangouts anyway, bro.
Doors are always open.
One thing before you end the show, could you share my YouTube link? It's in the private chat. Could you share it into the live chat, please? Because I'm trying to grow my channel.
Okay.
Subscribe to the homie Nippin, bro.
Yeah, man. So subscribe to the bro. Nippin. Okay, yeah,
you
man.
You a bitch at? No, I'm just kidding.
What the heck?
Okay. I really wish.
So let me hit that for you, man. So there you go. That is Nippon's thingy, man. That's Nippon's thing is right there, man. So
I expect at least like 200 subscribers. I don't know.
Come on,
big
man.
Big games.
I have 234.
Oh shit.
Okay. So guys, we thank you very much. Thank you for our guests coming in. Thank you for Nippon and Ak and so forth. And we'll see you guys next door. Remember to like, subscribe. Oh, and also as well, remember guys, if you want that Manscaped stuff, groom yourself, look sexy for the people, man. Link is below.
Do you want your balls to look like Half Hope's head?
Yeah, man. Look, man. So your thing coming? Because look, as small as my baby skin as my head.
No, I'm not going bald, Half Hope.
What? No, I never said you were going bald.
Sorry, I misunderstood.
He refuses to manscape.
Refuses to manscape. So
get him out. No.
So yeah. Remember, guys, shave your balls, make your balls look all good for that female friend of yours. Link
also
is below.
Bald the other one as well, man. The bald the other
yeah,
one.
Yeah, man.
Link is stink.
Link is below in the description box. Use the code CCS. Description box below. Use the code CCS to get 20% off. Support our sponsors, guys. Peace out. Stay true. Stay real. Stay sexy. One love. 1-1-1-1.